Okay, welcome to week five of Art 1.1. I have a couple quick announcements, and I'm guessing that everything was okay, but I should ask first before we get started, was there any kind of problem or issue or delay in signing on? Because I didn't think to hit the link at first. I sent the number by itself, the ID number, and then I went back and highlighted the copy link, it's called, on the host's, whatever. But this afternoon, it was completely malfunctioned, nothing to do with me. The Zoom itself booted me off, and then it booted some of my students off after I had to re-invite them to a new meeting, a second meeting. It was just something was happening. It could have something to do with what's going on in the world right now. One of my students said it's booting. Anyway, was everybody able to get on easily, or were there any issues?
Let me go. I had no issues getting on. It was just as it always is, easy.
Good. That's helpful to hear. Thanks. Well, okay. I am going to get started with the lecture because you could see we have a lot of slides, and at least a third of them, four or more out of the 12 that we're going to cover, are very likely to be on the, or at least are ones, I will say this, that I'm not, I'll tell you as I get to each of those slides. Of course, I've always done this. This is a slide that won't be cut from the study list. Of course, the midterm here is, you guys get, because of this early spring break, it's the earliest of any college I know of. Well, I guess several other colleges may have that, mid-March spring break. Our midterm, you guys, midterm isn't until after that. I think it's the 28th, but your papers are due 1 week from tonight. And so I have sent everyone that's, in general, I've sent the cover sheet and the previously, of course, 2 weeks ago, at least, the five requirements. We went over them on the Zoom class for the papers, as well as the sample of an A paper. But there's always a possibility somebody didn't get it. So if any of those are missing from your files, that is the cover sheet, a sample of an A paper, or the five requirements for your paper, please just email me, and please do it on AOL, because there's some weird thing. I can't forward things very easily from Outlook. It's such a cumbersome website. I hate it. And so do other teachers I've talked to. So I use it because we're required to. And if you send papers there to me for grading, that's not a problem. But when it comes to you're asking me, any student, not just this class, for individual forwarding of any documents, handouts, PDFs, it's much easier, much faster if you ask me on AOL. Okay, so is anybody here not, well, if you don't have one of those three handouts, you just should send me an email, like sometime before you go to bed tonight, and tomorrow, when I log back on, it's been a long day, you will get those handouts. Well, wait a minute, tomorrow? Nope, won't be tomorrow. Yes, it will, tomorrow, Tuesday, yeah. What day is this? Okay, anybody have any questions, though, about the papers themselves? And I'm going to hold up. I did it last week, but I'll do it again. Sample of what? Here we go. Let's let Claire in. A sample of welcome. We were just talking about the papers, and I'm not going to restate everything I just said, but I will have this. I'll hold this one up, how your short papers should be submitted. Obviously, you guys are 1.1. You can do the math on that, right? I have three different classes with different numbers, of course, and yet the procedure is the same. So you would write for this class, our 1.1 short paper number one, obviously not two, underline last name, comma, first name, and then send it to markw@aol. I should probably have written that on there, but it's pretty straightforward. You should know that email address because most of you haven't gotten in touch with me that way. If you get them to me by midnight next Monday, they will count as being on time. So in case you decide you have one or two more questions that you need to have me answer in class next week, or you just need the extra time after class to tighten up your paper, that's fine. As long as they get them by midnight on Monday, March 7th, they will be counted on time. Okay, any questions about that? Anything requiring, or actually I've gotten very little extra credit, but I understand usually the first several weeks in a semester, not too many people do. I am going to go ahead and do a little unusual thing because we've had the last week, 5 days now, I guess it is, since the attack by Russia on Ukraine. I'm going to keep this brief, but I got to tell you, it's personal with both me and my daughter, and I'll briefly say why. I think I told her, but my daughter, we adopted her from Russia, and she's very proud of the heritage of her country, but she's always, since she could start speaking, she's hated Putin because the man is a monster. I think the world sees that now, in case any of you didn't know, is one of the most disgusting, murderous, amoral leaders on the planet. And at this point, it's not just that, but the other part of the reason it's personal is with me and my daughter both. Now, we're friends, well, she got to meet through me, and I was friends with a family of Ukrainian scientists who befriended me on a train from Moscow to Kiev in 1990. Sorry, from Kiev to Moscow, the other way around. By the way, Ukrainians, when they speak the name of their capital city in English, they don't say Kiev, they say Kiev. I was just in touch with a couple of them recently. Luckily, the ones I got to know, they invited me to next time I was in, and I did go back in 91. That's the year that Ukraine became independent. So over 30 years ago, I was with them the night the Ukrainians in their living room on TV live announced the results. 92% of the population of the voters of Ukraine voted to become independent. And they were allowed to leave peacefully because they had a decent leader. That his name was Gorbachev. It was a humanitarian, you know, not a monster. It's very personal with me because even though that family's gone, they're all now living in Paris. They have, I just heard from them, aunts, uncles, cousins, and nieces and nephews still in Kiev. It's one of the most beautiful cities. That's the other thing I'll say. I've been there twice, and they showed me around. But it's the oldest big city in Russia, way older than Moscow. It's about 13 centuries old, and it was the original capital of a country known as, well, now today we call it Ukraine, before there was a Russia. So the whole idea that, you know, somehow Putin's not really taking over another country, of course, is poppycock, is putting it politely. So anyway, let's hope they can hold out long enough that he finally gets the message that he's...
Hey, do me a favor.
Okay, so let's go to our first slide. But first, we had a couple people just join us. Anybody have any questions about...
I did want to ask one about the paper.
Sure, please.
And I apologize if it is a pretty ridiculous question, but I just need to make sure...
No,
for the art that we get to choose, right? For anything that is obviously in the periods that we're talking about.
Right. It doesn't have to be from the periods. Any work of art you like, okay. Any period, any style, any artist. And the only limitation is it can't be your own artwork. That would be a little too easy. You wouldn't have to do any research, hopefully, on what the meaning was. So yeah, obviously it's a research paper. So that is it, the only limitation. Just needs to be something you care about. And well, of course, that you can find three sources for your bibliography, that you can quote a couple of them or cite them in the text, as well as list them in the bibliography. So they'll make sure, if it's graffiti art, it might be harder to do. But, you know, of course, if it's Banksy, right? That famous British mystery guy, I think everyone knows who he is. So in the art world in London, I'm sure he's well known, but whatever. The guy that won't reveal his name, something like that, you have no trouble. There have been documentaries on, but of course, if it's street art, that's harder. You might have trouble meeting the 5 requirements. And so that's my only other caution, is to make sure before you start working on a work of art that you want to write about, that you can find 3 new sources about, one of which needs to be originally printed if you want full credit. Okay, hope that helps. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Sure, you're welcome. You know, I'm going to say this just because I think you all know by now, I hope, after all these weeks we've been, you know, that to me, teaching is a two-way street. And so asking questions, let's admit, Sam, here, good timing. We're about to start with the first slide. I was just summarizing papers are due a week from today. And in any case, my father used to be a teacher of production art before computers. That's in the 70s, right? When there weren't any in classrooms, at least not in East LA, where he taught in the barrio. And he only spoke a little bit of Spanish. But anyway, his students, you know, they loved the class. And he used to tell them this the first day of class. Oh, don't hesitate to ask questions. Anytime during the, you know, my class sessions or before or after, raise your hand, you know, Because there are no stupid questions, only stupid people. But he was kidding, of course. But the students who had their hands up, oh, and they said, I should have done that. So that's my little tell. That's not my attitude. Any question is legitimate, obviously. And please ask them. Now, one more time, speaking of questions about the papers, since this is the last class you'll have before they're due, although I just said, and I think two people joined us after I said this, that you have until midnight on Monday if you want them to be turned in on time. So you could still even be working on them after the last lecture slide is done Monday, but midnight, Monday, March 7th is the deadline. Okay, last time, any questions about the papers? All right, let's get started. We have a lot to cover, and it's pretty interesting. And I think you'll see what I say in some ways, ironically relevant, this very first slide, based on what we were just briefly talking about with the current situation between Russia and Ukraine. Okay, so let's get this full screen, and I'm going to make sure you guys can, right? You can all see it, yes? Okay, this is a slide I'm not cutting from the study list. It's one of those that's very important. So you want to take extra careful notes, okay? All right, I assume you can all see it. No one said you can't. So let's proceed. Palace complex at Knossos. Palace, of course, everyone knows how to spell palace. Complex at Knossos, it was the capital city of the Minoans. And I'll explain that in a minute. K-N-O-S-S-O-S, Crete, okay? I think you probably know, but I'll spell that, C-R-E-T-E. That's the largest Greek island, but it wasn't part of Greece this far back. 1700 B.C. or B.C.E. So let's start with, who were the Minoans? Wow, what an amazing culture. And how refreshingly different they were than almost all the other ancient cultures or some other cultures or countries in the world today, the way some of them behave. The Minoans were, okay, the island culture that occupied almost, or to say most, of the islands off the coast of Greece. And they had a very advanced and prosperous and peaceful civilization, advanced, prosperous, and peaceful. I would use those words. And the evidence of why that is true, or why I say that, why historians say that, are three things about the Minoans, and that's M-I-N-O-A-N-S. You should have that seen that word in Stockstead by now. Hopefully you're all doing your reading before each lecture, right? But anyway, the Minoans, okay, they had three characteristics, you could say, of their culture that were different than almost every other culture in the ancient world. Okay, so obviously a very important part of the meaning of this. This was their capital. Knossos was the capital city on the largest Greek island of Crete, and this was the entrance of the palace. We'll talk about that in a little more detail in a minute. But what are those three features or three characteristics that the Minoans had that differentiated them from almost all other ancient cultures? First of all, they did not abuse or harm animals in their religious ceremonies, never. They believed in having animals, you'll see the evidence in the next couple slides, as part of their religious ceremonies, but they never harmed them. They didn't shed their blood, they didn't sacrifice them. They believed animals, in other words, had souls. And the three most sacred animals that they used in their religious ceremonies without harming them were bulls, snakes, okay, and the third one escapes me now. Okay, bulls, snakes, and dolphins. Bulls, snakes, and dolphins were sacred animals to the Minoans, and all the animals, those three species especially, that they did use in any religious ceremony were unharmed and usually released back into their natural habitat long before, you know, they would have passed away. So they were not abusing animals. They didn't sacrifice or harm animals in their religious ceremony. That's very unusual. We know, we saw that with the way lions were treated by various Middle Eastern kingdoms and rulers. Okay, the second characteristic of their culture that them from other ancient cultures, was this is a really major one. Men and women had equal power or shared, you could say, equal power and importance in both the political and religious life of their kingdom. I'll say it again. Men and women had equal importance and equal power. You could say shared power equally. There we go. That's a good way to say it. They shared power equally in both religious and political life of their kingdom. That's almost unheard of, right? Except when a woman happened to become queen of, as you know, happened, of course, with ancient Egypt three times only. But, you know, then women would have power. But that's the exception. Here, it was the norm. You'll see the proof of that as I go through the next few slides of this complex. Okay, and then the third thing is the part that what I was saying a moment ago might be particularly relevant and different than what we're seeing happening in the last week on the other side of the world, which is that they had no standing army and they never attacked or invaded any of their neighbors. In fact, they weren't an empire. All these other cultures we mentioned had at some point, you know, conflicts with their neighbors and usually tried to conquer, you know, one or more neighboring kingdoms. Not the Minoans. They did have a navy because they were an island culture. They kind of had to have a navy just to defend themselves. And, you know, also, you know, protect their shipping, but they did not have a standing army. Now, security guards, you know, in the palace, you know, for the king and queen. Yes, of course, that they had to have, but they did not have a standing army and they never attacked or invaded any of the neighboring kingdoms. And by the way, you might, some of you have caught this little subtle nuance. I'm not calling them an empire because empires mean it's a country that conquers and takes over other countries. That's not the Minoans. They had no conflicts with their neighbors. They were a kingdom, not an empire. Okay, can anybody think of a modern country? I'll go ahead and give you a clue. It's in the same continent, though not close to, luckily for the people that live there, where the fighting is happening in Ukraine, but it's in the same continent. It's a country today that is in, well, now it is in three ways, three of their those characteristics, but particularly the last one, not having a standing army and never having a conflict with their neighbors. When we think of a modern country in Europe that's true of, anybody? I bet at least one or two of you can think. Pretty famous country. It's not large. Nobody? Germany? Somebody said it.
Germany?
Oh, no, Germany. Germany's had a bunch of wars with their neighbors. Yeah, now they'd have it. Switzerland. Switzerland has never fought a war with any of their neighbors. And that, some people say, is why Hitler didn't try. He could easily have taken over Switzerland. Well, he would have had a fight on his hands, but he could have done it easily. But he never even attempted to because there was no point to it. There was, you know, the Swiss, well, in part because they were banking for everyone, including the Nazis. That's the only negative part of that. But I have many friends in Switzerland. I've been there several times. And one thing they absolutely are rightfully proud of is that they've never had a war with any of their neighbors.
I thought of Switzerland because I'm aware of like kind of like how they a little bit of their political side, but just like how their prison systems are and all these, it's just very, very different than what you see around the world. So that's why I thought of Switzerland.
Yeah. They also rehabilitation. They didn't, I don't know if anyone knows this, they didn't used to allow in every part of Switzerland, some, you know, districts they call it, like states or cantons, they call them in Switzerland, didn't allow women to vote until the 1970s, but you know, that's before most of you were born. So it's old history to you. I can remember when they, maybe as late as the 80s, at some point, one or two of their districts had to finally, but now men and women do have equal, and in their legislature, they have for decades. Yeah, no, it's the closest comparison. Anyway, so let's now finish up with the meaning on this slide. The bullhorns, it should be obvious, that's what these are, I think, right? If it isn't, you should write that. Sculpture of public art. See, they had public art then, right? Well, of course, that's true of almost all ancient cultures. But here, these are so modern looking. Some historians almost, you know, say they were the first abstract sculptors. I mean, these are bullhorns, but you can see they're stylized. That makes them almost abstract. Although you can, once you know that's what they are, you can see where you know, the hint of actual shape of a bull's horns comes here, comes into this work of art. But it's a giant, obviously huge. It's I've been through this palace complex. These are about like 10 feet tall, or more than that, like 12 feet. So that large piece of sculpture is what? Symbolic of their worshiping of bulls. I just told you that was one of the three secret, right? Sacred, most sacred animals to them. So the bull horns are public sculpture, public art, symbolizing their worshiping of bulls. And then this is the entrance, if it's not obvious, the entry hall, long, narrow hallway leading into the palace complex, which I'm going to show you. But this would be the view if it's on the midterm. You'll have this view, not another one. So we'll do the form analysis in just a moment. But only other thing to mention is these columns are specifically, especially the round one, invented the style, the shape of them, right? That it's called the style or shape of a column. These are Minoan inventions. They came up with this type or style of column, and they were copied. You'll see the proof of that in other parts of the Mediterranean, way beyond their own kingdom. Okay, so let's do the formal elements. Let's start with space. It's a long, narrow hallway with about a 15-foot high ceiling. That's it. That's the entrance to the palace complex, right? You go down that hallway and then there's different rooms. You'll see some of those in a few moments. So you see this, again, for real space, there's no techniques for space, is a long, narrow hallway with about a 15-foot high ceiling. It's balanced, yes, even though this column is round and that's square, they're the same width and height. So I would say it's balanced and the two walls are symmetrical. Now you could include the stairs, and that's okay if you think of it that way, because that's the way the photographer took this. It's not my photo. But there's the same amount of stairs on three sides, you know, leading from this direction, from the opposite side of the plaza. They all end up at a open plaza. So yes, it's balanced. However you look at it, from this, the steps all the way up to the top of the entry hall. It's balanced left to right, and here we go. Welcome. We're just on our first slide. This is the first must know, and it's very important. It won't be cut from the study list again. The palace complex at Knossos, and I already spelled that. So you see, it's the first slide on your syllabus for tonight. Okay, so let's do the rest of the formal elements. I say it's balanced left to right. If you want to say, because the stairs are much wider, of course, than the entry hall, the width of that, which is clearly not as wide as all these stairs on either side. Yeah, you can make the case that it's unbalanced toward the bottom, but definitely it's balanced left to right. The rhythm is obvious. Each stair set of steps and the two bull horns, and even though the columns are slightly different shape, they create rhythm, you know, in terms of the dimensions, the height and the width. And then there's, of course, the stones on the stone wall that are similar shapes. So lots of rhythm. Is it mostly stable? Yeah. The only things dynamic are, you know, the shape of the column, one of the two columns. And I guess you could say the inside of the bullhorn sculpture, right? Everything else is totally stable. All the texture is a real texture. There's the real rough texture of the stone on the stairs and on the walls, and the real smooth texture of the bullhorn sculpture. And these are wood, real smooth painted wood textures on the two columns. The modeling is, of course, just the natural shadows from the sun. There is painted lime here. You see that on top of these two columns, between, you know, where the black lines are painted. Otherwise, the lines are all visual, right? Along the edges, like with most architecture, of the or corners of the building and on the sculpture here. So most of the line is visual, but there's some painted line on the two columns. And it's actually kind of bold line too. It's kind of thick. Okay, it's cool on the columns and the stairs and the bullhorn sculpture. Warm on the actual structure of the entry hall itself on both the walls and the ceiling. Warmer tones. And then let's see, stable, dynamic, balanced, rhythm. Am I forgetting something? I'm trying to remember. Texture, I think we covered it all. Yeah. Okay. So now this next few slides, you can just listen and take a look. This was the entry. It's not on the syllabus, so not the entry, sorry. This was the balcony around the corner from, so you'd take stairs this way towards, that's the edge of the palace complex where we were just looking. This whole site, it was this, actually you could add one last fact of meaning. You don't have to, but it is part of the meaning of the first slide, that this whole site was buried for thousands of years. And those buildings you see now are partially restored from ruins that were found under rubble. Thousands of years they were buried. Anybody know? Well, actually, this you probably should add as the meaning of all, like you could say it's relevant to the meaning of all of the first three slides. They're all of Minoan sites or Minoan artifacts. Anybody know what happened to the Minoans? What destroyed them? Let's go ahead and go to.
They drowned them.
Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead.
The city drowned.
Overflowed. That's basically correct. But what caused the tidal waves? What led to that? Before the tidal waves happened, they were caused by anybody? Somebody?
Wasn't there a giant volcano eruption time that was basically the basis for the Atlantis myth?
Right. Yes, that is the source of the Atlantis myth. And it's interesting you brought that up because time permitting, probably not tonight, we'll see, maybe next week, I can show you my own slides of Atlantis. I hope that gets your attention. Yeah, the real Atlantis. No, many historians think that one of the Greek islands, Santorini, which is one of the most beautiful places I've ever been to. I have some really good slides of that. And yes, one of the Minoan islands, and maybe some think the entire kingdom of all those islands together is the source for the myth of Atlantis. So you could add that. But the point is that this is a fact, no myth here, that as the last two comments you both made, you're both correct. First, there was a giant series of volcanic eruptions, and that led to earthquakes, which of course led to tsunamis. Tidal waves, which then, yes, destroyed their city. So if they weren't knocked down first by earthquakes, right, which usually is enough, these were big earthquakes, probably 9-point-something. Anyway, just say massive earthquakes following, of course, volcanic eruptions. Then what was left was, yes, definitely flooded by tidal waves. Tsunami is the word, of course. Yeah, so that's how the culture ended. It wasn't from war or famine. They were very prosperous. They didn't have poverty and hunger. Pretty amazing culture. All right, so you'll have to take notes on the next 3 or 4 slides, but these are those columns we saw, but here they're painted a different color. The Minoan invention of the columns taper the wrong way. You'd think they'd go the other way where they get wider at the bottom, but here they get wider at the top. And then they have these same kind of, some people say disc, type of capital. The capital is always the word for the top of a column. You won't have to know that term. It's not on your list of terms. So these are distinctively Minoan style columns. They've been restored, you know, in fact, maybe even reconstructed, but some parts of them were found. So we know what they look like and what the height and width was and the colors on them. And then this was the king's throne room. They had both a king and a queen, dual. Let's see what I was saying earlier about male and female rulers having equal and shared power. There's no exaggeration or simplifying of that. It's a fact. You can see the proof throughout the evidence of their remaining, you know, sites of their culture. So here we have a throne room with these wonderful, obviously been greatly restored, but we know this was the room where the king would have been. There's evidence of that. Anybody know what these creatures are called? They're mythical creatures that many ancient cultures worshipped or believed in anyway. They have the head of a lion, the body of a lion and the head of a bird. Okay.
I believe it's hippogriff?
Well, that could be another word for them. Griffin is what I'm thinking of.
Griffin. Those are two different creatures. One's...
Yeah, I think they are different. Yeah, but you guys don't have to know that because it's not part of that must-know slide. I just wanted you to see they obviously... also had some common animal worship with other ancient cultures, because griffins are found in some Egyptian, definitely Babylonian, and Greek, later on Greek art. You know, a lot of ancient cultures believed in the mythical creature called a griffin. And here's another view of that throne. Awfully small throne, isn't it? And a much more comfortable room That's a close-up of one of the griffins. It's beautifully done. Now, that's heavily restored, but they found enough of pieces of the, you know, of course, it had fallen off during the earthquakes and then was covered by rubble or flooded. But this is still being excavated, this site. I don't know if it is right, you know, in the last few years, but over the last few decades, British and I believe American, French, maybe German, and definitely Greek archaeologists continuing to excavate that site. Now, here are the dolphins, also sacred animals to them that they worship, on the wall behind the queen's throne. See, there's the queen's throne. It's like a giant hassock, right? And her room was the coolest room in the cove. When I was there, it was like 110 degrees, and there was no shade, no trees, nothing like that around here. You had to walk a significant distance from the nearest bus stop. It was outside the main city of Crete. Yeah, it was a very hot, uncomfortable day. But in here, it was a good 15 degrees cooler. Why? Because of how clever they were with the ventilation. That's a louvered, you'll have to write in this, but a louvered ceiling, which helps bring, you know, of course, when the heat rises, it helps circulate it out through these tall, open, they're not windows even, passageways. And you see how they did that. Here's, because they didn't have glass, not in this culture. Ancient Egypt had some glass, but not windows. The Romans are the first culture to use glass for windows, at least in Western history. So here we see big open ventilation shafts. However you want to call it, it was noticeably cooler and much more comfortable and really beautiful. I loved looking at these dolphins here. When you get up close, you can get some ideas, another view of it. Yeah, different photographer, different time of day, I guess. But these dolphins, definitely you can see they believe they had a soul, a spirit. They were intelligent creatures, and they did not harm them when they had them in their religious ceremonies. And they would release them after maybe, you know, a year or so of having them in their peaceful religious ceremonies. Okay, this is the next must know. We'll be cutting this one from the study list either. This is, according to Stockstad, though most historians do not use this title, but I'll use hers. Snake goddess. We don't know. It could be a priestess or it could be a goddess. So I'll explain those two main theories in a minute. But first of all, just the title is just like it sounds, two words, snake goddess. Crete, the same location, right? C-R-E-T-E. And this is 1600 or 1600 BC or BCE. Okay, so the leading theory, or just again, it's safer to say many historians believe that this is actually an image of a high priestess. I just said a few, you know, moments ago, right, that the Minoans had equal roles or shared importance, right, for male and female, members of their culture in both their religious and their political life. Well, here's an example, the proof of that. This is a religious ceremony called the snake ceremony. Remember, I said they had three sacred animals. One of them was snakes. Well, these were live poisonous snakes, and they were not defanged or their poison wasn't taken out. So this, I believe this makes sense. In fact, I've been to the museum where this is. It's actually back in Athens, I think it is. And this snake goddess here, if it's a goddess, would be, just begs the question, it makes more sense that it's an actual human conducting a ceremony worshiping the snake goddess, because we know they had such a ceremony and we know their priestesses, say that fast five times, their female priests, the high priests, of course, would have conducted the ceremonies, and they would have had this kind of an outfit, open, right, literally, jacket, leather headdress. That's a leather headdress, leather apron, and then a pleated skirt. And they conducted a ceremony known as the snake ceremony, in which they were trying to induce the worshipers, you know, in a temple, obviously, into a trance-like state of mind. Well, you kind of might not be able to take your eyes off of something like this, because those snakes literally are dangerous to the point of potentially deadly. And look at her face. She was in a trance, if this is an actual human priestess. And would almost something have to have had some kind of libation or something to get herself into the state of mind where she's willing to risk her own safety to conduct the ceremony. And of course, that would have gotten the attention of a room full of worshipers. But what's this up here? Speaking of risk, and anybody want to hazard what that is? It should be obvious. I think it's obvious what kind of an it's an animal, obviously, on top of her hat. What does it look like to anybody here? Nobody has a guess? I'm going to wait. Somebody here must have an idea of what kind of animal that looks like. It's not a rare animal.
Is it a cat or an owl?
Yeah, it's probably, yeah. There we go. Just say probably a very nervous cat. That would add to the trance-like, you know, attention or focus that the worshipers would have been paying to this ceremony happening right in front of them, right? I mean, we're not talking about auditoriums, you know, of 1,000 people. These were temples with maybe a couple hundred at most in the, you know, watching this, probably several dozen. So if you watched a woman conducting a ceremony like this, who herself is already in a trance and she's probably chanting or singing, then you know she's got two live poisonous snakes. And then on top of that, she's got a cat perched on top of her head. You probably would be paying attention. Right, so that's the leading theory. Well, just say one of the two theories. And the other theory is that it isn't an actual portrait of a human priestess, but rather some kind of a goddess. That's always possible, but it just doesn't make sense to me to say that then this was just somebody making a ceremony that is about the snakes, but not actually the person conducting it. We know they had such priestesses and that they dressed this way and that this is the kind of ceremony they conducted. Okay, so that's plenty on the meaning. You already know who the Minoans were and that this was found in the ruins of the palace complex at Knossos, by the way. You could add that. So let's do a formal analysis. Well, it's a human figure and it's intact, so it is balanced left to right symmetrically. I think you could make the case it's balanced top to bottom, too. If you draw the line here, roughly halfway down the leather apron, see it's, yeah, there we go. Welcome back. Okay, we're just doing the formal analysis. This is roughly balanced top because the two arms and the two snakes and the top part of the body, if you draw the line down about halfway down the apron, it's roughly equal mass, especially when you add the cat on top. But some people think it's weighted a little more to the bottom because of the wide dress. So that's up to you. It's got the rhythm of the dress itself, of course, the decorative patterns on that leather apron, the two breasts, the two arms, the two snakes, the two eyes. Obviously, a lot of rhythm. It is mostly stable. Well, you got to say both, really. But she's standing upright and her arms are out at almost the right angle. They are from her body, except her lower arms. But you could make the case, of course, when you add the fact that obviously the hat she's wearing, her breasts and the leather apron and the pleats in the skirt are dynamic. So it's both. Here, the texture is superb. The texture is painted and carved because her face, let's go do a close-up. That's carved, her eyes, her nose, her mouth. And on her hands, there's car and the cat too on her head there. Those are all carved lines that create symmetric texture, but most of the lines that create the symmetric texture are painted. And they are both thin, the painted lines. Well, don't see a lot of thin lines. Actually, now that I think about it, the lines that are painted, well, yeah, I guess they are kind of. On the apron border, it's definitely thick lines. Okay, and then we have, I think I already mentioned the rhythm. Let's see what. Oh, space. This is about 18 inches tall, and there is overlapping as the only technique for space. The hat, her hat overlaps her head. The snake overlaps the hat. Her hands overlap the snakes, and her clothes overlap her body, obviously. And then we have, there's no technique for modeling. It's the museum lighting. And then finally, we would have to say, masses. She's the largest mass. And then probably it's a close call between the snakes, her hat, and the cat. The cat on the hat, not the cat in the hat. The last thing is about color, and this is misleading. The original colors here were white on her face. Not that that was the color of her skin. She was Mediterranean. She certainly had darker skin. And it's just that it's faded over the centuries, right? It's been on display for at least 200 years, I think. Anyway, for generations it's been. And also it was found under rubble. So some of the white paint on her face has worn off. So part of her face is cool. The other part is the actual material itself. But of course, her dress is a mixture, as you can see by the different patterns of cool blue and warm red or orange and yellow. So it's alternating. Same thing is true for her blouse. Okay, let's move on to, I know I've been saying this, but this is another important one, because all three of these put together give you some idea of what's unique about their culture. So this one I won't be cutting from the study list. Bull jumping fresco, right? Just like that sounds, three words. Bull jumping fresco from Knossos. Spell it again, Knossos. Crete, I've already spelled twice, so you should know that word, is the island, right, where the biggest island the Minoans occupied or lived on. They didn't really occupy it, that was their homeland. 1500 BC, 1500 BCE, according to Stockstead. So what do we see here? We see one of their religious ceremonies in which their sacred animals, the bull, the most sacred animal to them was the bull, was never harmed. This is not bullfighting. In fact, the only potential harm is to the human, priests. That's what they are, acrobats. Some say acrobats, but they're both. These are the females. I think I haven't mentioned this. So if I haven't, you definitely want to write this. It'll apply to the next couple of weeks of slides. That in the ancient world, well, I did with the Egyptians. I know I did. When men and women are shown in the same scene, the women were shown with lighter color, usually white skin tones, even though that's not the actual color of their skin, of course. And then we have this male shown with a darker skin tone. And yet they all would have had the same skin tone here, right? They're all from the same island, same Mediterranean culture. That's just an artistic device, but it is a consistent one used throughout most of the ancient cultures in the Mediterranean. Okay, so what are they doing? Well, if you look close, you can see this woman here is grabbing the horns of a charging bull. Talk about taking a risk. You'd easily be gored to death. And then she's about to do, as soon as this guy's finished, what he just did, which is leaping over the back of the bull and being caught by a female, again, a priestess, at the other end, behind the bull. And they just would do it over and over and over, the same ritual. And as you could tell, the bull was not only not harmed, the only harm potentially here was to the humans. So this is another part of that set of three features I mentioned that make them unique. No animals were harmed. That's not just a line at the end of a movie credits reel. It's the truth for this culture. They didn't believe in harming or letting the blood of any of the animals that they worshipped. Okay, the only other thing to add is that this, you see this where the dark blue is and the darker shades on the bull's body? Those are the original pieces found in shards, literally shards, under collapsed walls from that set of earthquakes, right, that destroyed the palace. This was from one of the main walls at the palace complex, and now it's been reassembled and restored. Obviously, the lighter blue is not obvious. You should write this. The light blue areas are the new material to fill in where it was missing. So the acrobats / priests are mostly original. Most of the bull's body is, and then a lot of the wall, though, isn't. So it was found in pieces, and it was assembled and restored, and then parts were recreated. So it could be shown in a museum. It's in a museum in Athens, I think. And then the last thing you could say is about that. We don't know what these are. Some people think that they're rocks under a stream, like you'd see smooth rocks that tend to get after, decades at the bottom of a clear water stream. You've all seen that at some point, right? When you go out in the countryside. And that's one theory, that these are meant to look like rocks underneath the water of a stream, because Crete's a big island, so it's not just surrounded by water, it has fresh water on the island. None of the other Greek islands do. They have to import the water, but this one, well, none of the smaller ones do. But here they had their own fresh water. Okay, so if it's not a freshwater creek with stones at the bottom, what else could it be? Planets or comets in the sky? That's another theory. And the final theory, the one I think makes most sense, it's just a bunch of geometric shapes as a decorative pattern for the border. Maybe no symbolic meaning to it. All right, formal analysis. Really good Sumerian texture on the hair of the bull. And look at the horn. That's quite well done. And then their hair, which is in dreads, all three of them, the man and the two women, that's Sumerian texture. On their bodies, there isn't really any. And there is no modeling here. Well, maybe on the horns. I guess you could say just that, on the horns of the bull. And the line is mostly bold. Bold definitely on the horn's body. I meant the bull's body, not the horn's body. On the outside of the bull's body, that's bold line. But the three human priests or athletes, I think they're really both priests/athletes, those lines are obviously, the outlines are thin there. It's totally dynamic. This woman is standing upright. So you could make the case that the one mostly stable part is most of the body of the priestess to the on the far right. But this one is in motion. She's about to jump. And then the bull is totally dynamic. And so is the male priest. So it's mostly dynamic. For space, there's only overlapping, obviously. Overlapping the hands over the horn, so the bull's horn, and the male priest over the back of the bull, and I guess their loin cloths. There's a phrase you don't hear very often on all three of them. That's the only clothing they're wearing, because they wouldn't want to have robes on when they're doing this. Okay, and let's see, the largest mass, easy, the bull, and then the two females, and then the males, the third and smallest mass, because the two women are about the same height. Interestingly, he's sort of like jockey size, right? But anyway, that would be in that order. And then let's see, warm colors, of course, on the bull, and the male athlete, cool colors on the two female, again, priestesses or athletes. And is it balanced? I would say the two women are about the same height and the male is in the middle, but the bull's body, some people feel more, it's larger, more of it is visible on the left half of his body. You decide. I think it's roughly balanced, both top to bottom and left to right. Okay, moving along. We're doing pretty well on time here. These next two slides you can just watch. This is the first major, or not the first, the largest and most powerful of all the early Greek city-states. We're going to talk about it with the next must know, but we're not there yet, so you just listen. This is near the coast of Greece. In fact, the Aegean Sea is just out there. It was such a overcast day, you couldn't see the actual water, but it would be visible. It's on a hill. It's called Mycenae, and it was the largest and most powerful of the early Greek city-states. There was no Athens when this city was built. And we're going to see the next must know, the main gate to it. But these are the walls that they've been partially restored, but they didn't need to rebuild them from scratch because a lot of the stone, look at that stonework. There's no mortar in it. These are my own slides here. And they just held together because it was so, it's called fitted. That's, you know, as in F-I-T-T-E-D, fitted stone was the technique used to make stone walls in a large part of the ancient world. And that's not just in the Western world. The Incas did that. And to some degree, the Mayans and some parts of China, that was done too. It's a technique before mortar was either used, invented, available, whatever needed. And they just, the stones hold together on their own because of the shape and the weight. Okay, now this is the next must know. Yes, Samuel, please.
Go ahead. I was just gonna say that when I was in Peru, I saw the walls, and I had a chance to go to Machu Picchu.
Oh, and I would love that. We're going to, you notice that we're going to cover Machu Picchu, and it's further down after the midterm. It's, you don't have to do a thing if you don't want to, but Samuel, but it would be nice since you brought that up, and I haven't been there. This is one of the only two continents I've been to, South America and Australia. So if you have any material about that, slides, or for extra credit, you could just, you know, submit them as a PDF or one
slide. Yeah, I have a few pictures from that trip.
It might be possible. I don't know. I'm not very good at this, but I can ask my tech-savvy daughter, who is taking art history classes, in fact, at the JC, if she can help make them. If not, even just for sending them in. you get some extra credit, 5 points. Mm-hmm. You know, just a few. But then if you want to add some kind of an article about it, it'd be another 5 points, you know, like about that, what you, you know, what it is you're showing in the slides. If mm-hmm. you find some kind of printed article or wrote a short thing yourself, just to
see. Yeah. I know that they're limiting the number of people that like are going there just because the ground there is so compacted.
Oh yeah. I heard they were going to, they already are now, not because of COVID, you mean?
Yeah. Just prior to COVID.
Hmm. Yeah, well, that's what, as you know, happened to Stonehenge. I mentioned that. And as one of my former students said, it's all your fault. But I wasn't the only one that tried to ever sleep outside of this circle of stones there. I know that's true because I read something about it when I got home. you know, it's a magazine article. There was no internet in the 70s. Okay, let's do this one as our next must know. And I'm not going to say this is so important. It absolutely won't be cut, or it might. But either way, for now, assume it might be on the midterm. It's the lioness, that's ESS, right? The female lion, lioness gate at Mycenae. And that's Mycenae, Greece. Now we're on the mainland of Greece here with this light. 1250, 1250 BC or BCE. So what do we see here? We see the main gate to, I'll say it again, now you should be writing this, the largest and most powerful of the early Greek city-states. This is in the archaic period. Now, after the break, I'm going to do this now while I'm talking to you. So since you guys don't have to, I can keep talking and see what I'm doing. I have to pull out something. I made a graphic to help explain some of this, and I almost forgot about having it. So I'm going to pull that out and show it to you when we get after the break, right before. I do the pause the sharing thing. But the point is, archaic is an important word to know in relation to this in the next couple slides. Archaic means the earliest period of any culture's history, when their art was less advanced, less skilled. We used to use the word primitive. That's really not accurate. So I wouldn't use that word. But I've just now found those three handouts. I mean, they're not handouts. What am I saying? You've got enough handouts for now. My own drawings, and this is maybe a little one step up from Mickey Mouse art. I'll show these to you when we get to, you know, the second half at the end of the break, okay, before we do our remaining must-knows. I don't want to interrupt this part of the lecture. So what do we have here? We have the main gate to the most powerful and the largest, and therefore obviously it should be obvious, wealthiest of all the early or archaic, just like it sounds, you all heard that word, but probably not used in connection with history, archaic period of Greek history, when the earliest city-states were founded and their art was not as developed, you could say, or as advanced as it got to be later during classical Greek times, which we will explain what that is after the break when we get to those slides. Okay, so what are we looking at here? We're looking at lions. Of course, the title tells us female lions, lionesses. And they're flanking a, look at that. Does that look familiar? It should. It's a Minoan style column, just like what we saw in the last few slides when I showed you my slides. By the way, those ones of the interior of that palace complex, I actually bought those there on the site. So, you know, professional slides, right? It's just a distinctive type of column that has a particular shape to it. So what does that tell us? Well, if it's not obvious, you should write this. The Mycenae Greeks, or you could say early Greek city-states, say it that way, because it didn't only apply to Mycenae, but the early Greek city-states traded with the Minoans. The Minoans were the wealthiest culture in the Mediterranean at that time, and they were peaceful. They were no threat to anybody. You could say that's how they are similar to the Switzerland of their day, if you want to call them that. And so they were, you know, not anybody's enemy or a threat to anybody. And so they would trade with the Egyptians, with the Babylonians, with the early Greeks. And the proof is right there in this keystone. Let's call it a keystone, right? That is above the, this should look familiar, hopefully, to all of you. The, right, monolith and lintel, the same exact structure that was used at Stonehenge, exactly the same. Of course, here it's incorporated into a wall, but it's the same function. And as I said, it's the oldest form of architectural construction or support system ever developed by human beings. all over, anywhere there's urban, permanent, you know, cities, in other words, well, no cities permanent, but you know what I mean, meant to be, right, long-term occupied urban centers, then you're going to have this technique of monolith and lintel. So that's what these are. So which, we'll get to the formal elements. Well, it's hard to say if the lintel here is big, as big or bigger than the keystone. But since the lions are missing their heads and the keystone would have gone at least up to about the top of the slide, I would say that's probably was the main piece. Of course, that holds together, right? It stabilizes in place, however you want to write that, keeps in place the stones around it. So the other facts about this, this was the main gate, but it's also, the gate itself is gone, of course. It also was one of the few cities, ancient Greek or early archaic Greek cities, that was never successfully occupied or attacked. It may have been attacked, but it was never occupied by an attacking army because the walls were 25 feet high. 25 feet. They are missing the top 3 feet, roughly. So they're now about 22 feet, the part that you can still see there. The highest stone is about 22 feet above ground. And so originally they were a total of about 25 feet high. And the last fact about the meaning of this is, I think it may be the most interesting. This is the city from which the Trojan War was launched, because it was the king of Mycenae's brother. So that would make his wife the what? Sister-in-law of the king of Mycenae, who was, quote, kidnapped or eloped. No one knows. Did she go willingly to Troy with the prince of Troy? Or did they kidnap her? There's no way to know for sure. The Greeks felt she'd been kidnapped, so they sent 1,000 ships. It's no exaggeration. Not just this city. They wouldn't have had quite that many ships just for one city, but they got all the other Greek city-states to join them to attack the Trojans. And there began that very famous episode of ancient history called the Trojan War. Now, have you ever seen the movie Troy? With Brad Pitt of all, they actually does a pretty good job of portraying Achilles. We're going to see Achilles, in fact, and I think it's the next slide, or not the next one of the next couple. So what you have is this beginning, the city in which the Trojan War began, because it was at a feast inside the city walls where Helen, the wife of the king's brother, was abducted or eloped in the middle of the night. From, you know, this ceremony where they were peacefully, you know, celebrating with the Trojans. And that's what started the Trojan War. So it's a pretty important city in the history of the ancient Mediterranean. Okay, so let's do a formal, everything is cool. It's just totally obviously a gray off kind of dark gray color, but there's no warm colors here. There is some similar texture on the lions and the column that they're flanking. And that's done with carved line, but most of the texture is the real rough texture of the stone. And most of the lines are visual around the stones. And that's how we can see that's a bas relief panel. But I know you all know that word, it'll come up for sure on the midterm. So the shadows, natural modeling is created by the shadows from the sun between each stone and around the objects in the keystone. There's no technique for modeling. I mentioned space already, but I'll repeat it. It's real space. There's no techniques for space here. I don't see any overlapping in this keystone, not really. So it's just the actual dimensions of the 25 foot tall stone walls with about a 12 foot high opening or gateway. I don't know who that woman is. It's not my son. I've had people ask, who is she? No. Some earlier professor at the JC, I'm sure, who took a tour of Greece and brought back these slides. It's from the slide library. Okay. And then let's see. Well, we have the rhythm. Of course, each block of stone and then the two monoliths have the same shape, the two lions, the repeated shapes. It's almost all stable on the walls. The only thing dynamic is the angle of the two lions' bodies. But even there, their paws or their legs, I meant to say, and the column are stable. It's mostly stable. Balanced, totally symmetrical, completely symmetrical left to right when the wall was intact and, you know, reached the full height. But definitely because now it's open, so it's all you could write about is what you see here. When there was a gate that was closed, it would have been symmetrical top to bottom and left to right. But that gate's missing a long time ago, obviously. I don't know if it was stone or wood, but in any case, or metal, I should say, metal or wood. But in any case, now you would make the case that it's unbalanced toward the top. If you drew the line roughly halfway, if it's 25 feet, then and that's 12 feet, then that's pretty much right there at the bottom of the lintel is the midline. So it's still roughly balanced, but there is the big open space. So you can make the case it's unbalanced toward the top. Let's see, am I forgetting anything? Texture, modeling, balance, rhythm. I think I covered that all. Space. Right? Don't believe I missed anything. All right. So this, I may have cut this off the study list for this class. Yeah, I did. So you don't have to write this. This is one of the tombs of one of their kings. It was found intact with the king's body in a sarcophagus and all his worldly possessions, gold, silver, precious metals, and stones. This is a beehive tomb. Their rulers were buried inside mountains, you know, deep buried into the side of a mountain where they carved out a beehive shaped tomb. Let's see if I have another. Yeah, there's it. It's looking up at it. It's literally shaped like a beehive. And so they got that idea from, you can guess what culture they were emulating, burying their rulers in a stone tomb, which they then put all their worldly possessions in with them. Well, the Egyptians, they were inspired by the Egyptians, the Mycenae culture. Yeah, this was one of the few found intact with all the objects, including the body of the deceased king inside. But it's not a must know, so we can keep going. No, this is from the island of Santorini. It's not a must know either, but I really like this piece. what we see here is two teenagers boxing on the island of Santorini. I think we might have time for me to show you just the last, it wouldn't take more than about 12 to 15 minutes to show you my own slides. We'll see how it goes when we finish with the last slides of ancient Greek art. Anyway, these are two teenagers boxing, and they, again, this was a nonviolent culture. They would stop any kind of contest because this would be like, you know, an athletic contest in a class, probably. I don't know if it was like public education class, like PE or not. I'm not sure about that. But they would have had training at some point. But if any blood was drawn, they stopped the boxing match because their goal was not to pummel each other, but to learn how to defend yourself, you know, in case you ever needed to, and also coordination and, you know, stamina and all that. But they didn't believe in getting bloody, unlike modern boxing matches in so many parts of the world, well, mostly here in the U.S. Anyway, so these two have dreads. You see that? Their hair is in dreads, and that's how they wore their hair in that culture. Okay, this is an important slide. The next must know. This is Dipilon vase. That's Dipylon. It's a funny word, I know. Vase, two words. Dipylon vase. Greece again. And this, we know the city was from Athens. I think everybody knows how to spell Athens, right? 750 BC or BCE. Okay, this is an archaic Greek painted vase. Remember, I already said what archaic is. So here what we have is a kind of vase. A Dipylon vase is not a separate term, so you don't have to write a new definition. It's not on your list of terms, but it's part of the meaning of this slide. So what is a Dipylon vase? Is a vase with a narrow base and a wide opening with two handles or handles on either side, meant or used, I say used, for carrying large quantities of liquids or dry goods. Literally, that's what it is. You could either put wine or some other liquid in here, or you could put any kind of, you know, dry goods. Mostly, of course, we're talking about spices maybe, or flour or something you use for cooking. And it was always a functional object, but it also is decorative. And so that's what we're going to focus on, the two scenes that are painted on the side of it. So let's go up close and we'll see. This is the funeral of Achilles. Now, if you don't know who he was, well, you can kind of, if this was on, I probably won't be cutting this slide. I mean, I might, but it's a higher than average possibility of being on the midterm. That you do need to know who Achilles was in case it's on the essay part of the exam. If you don't, then you should write this. He was their greatest warrior, their hero. Remember what a hero was? We already explained that a couple of weeks back. In the ancient world, a hero is a different meaning than we have today. Hero was half god, half human, born of a human. One parent was a human or mortal, and the other was a god or goddess. So that's what Achilles was. And that meant he was superhuman, his strength, right? But he was mortal. Well, obviously he's mortal. Here he is dead on top of his own funeral pyre. And this is his funeral. And these are the other warriors, his fellow Greek warriors, mourning him. They haven't lit the fire yet. These might have been his two pet dogs. It's hard to say, but that would be most people's guess. And you see they're about to light this, the fire here. These two attendants. Okay, so how did he die? Anybody know? I bet one or two of you do. It looks like somebody was about to ask a question or share something.
Arrow in the ankle.
Yeah, because he had one weakness. You want to, it sounds like you know, mention how he became vulnerable because of his, in his infancy, what happened to him, his mother.
Anybody? I'm not sure if this is the correctness since there's multiple different versions, but he was dipped into one of the underworld lakes.
Yeah, and which gave him, right. But by what? How was he dipped? By what?
His mother was holding him by basically the spot.
The heel. Yeah, right. So that's why the only part of his body that was vulnerable, there is no other word for that. Vulnerable. Don't ask me to spell it. Just write it the way it sounds. Vulnerable, right? The only part of his body that was vulnerable, or you could say could be harmed if you want to write it that way, was his heel, because the rest of his body was protected by this magic water in this magic lake or river. I thought it was a river, but yeah, there are different versions. But the point is, his mother had to hold on to him, right? Otherwise, he'd disappear. She held on to him by his heel. So what happened? He was shot with a poison arrow in that heel by one of the Trojan warriors who found out about that weakness. You could say it's his weakness. The phrase Achilles' heels to this day still, I think most of you heard that, means just that. What is a person's weakness? I guess we'll find out what Putin's is, and hopefully it's his own people. They get fed up with him enough. So what you see here is his funeral after he was killed with the only, by being shot in the only part of his body that was vulnerable. So these are Greek soldiers mourning their hero. Literally, it's the funeral of Achilles, A-C-H-I-L-L-E-S. Again, these are other words that aren't on the syllabus. You can look up or just spell as close as you can, because you don't get points off for writing or spelling. I mean, of the words, as long as I know what you're saying, since you want to at least get close. If we spell every word you've never heard before, we'll never get through the semester. So I'll just say Achilles is as close as you can write that to phonetically. It was their greatest hero. And so below, what is this scene? This is the battle that followed after the funeral, after I don't know how many days they mourned, several days. Then they attacked the Trojans with vengeance, right? They were going to try and take the city. They didn't. You know how they did eventually with the Trojan horse, which came at the end of that war. But this is before that. So this is still when they were fighting outside the walls of Troy, the Greeks. So these are supposed to be horses. We're going to talk about the poor quality of the painting here in a minute. And soldiers with shields in battle formation, attacking the walls of Troy. I'm going to go ahead and do this because I think it's kind of interesting. I have to be careful or I'll wreck my throat. I did one night too, and I also gave myself neck pain. This is the traditional ancient Greek way of mourning, and it's still practiced in some small villages in rural Greece. I know I saw, when I was there in the 80s, that far back, a Greek funeral in some village that we happened to be driving through. Me and my Greek and American friends were in a rental car, and we drove through this village, and they were doing what these people are doing. See, that's their arms. That's supposed to be their arms above their head. So if you could visualize holding it, their arms in a rectangular pattern and going over and over and over, walking in a circle around the dead person's body. Of course, now they don't mostly cremate them. I think it's around their coffin, whether it's open or closed is up to each family. But they still do that in some parts of Greece. But that's how all of the mourning was done in ancient Greece. It's a very strange sound. Anyway, so let's wrap this up with the formal elements. It's completely symmetrical left to right, and of course, unbalanced toward the top. but we have to pretty much focus on the scenes to analyze the other elements. Obviously, there is no similar texture. If it's not obvious, this is all, these were originally solid. So that would make these what? Silhouettes. So there's no modeling and no similar texture, none. But there is line, bold outline on parts, like on the funeral pyre, funeral pile, I guess, right? And then down here we have lines, bold, again, outlines around the shields, at least one of the shields, and I would say on this one too. Pyre, that's what I'm looking for, P-Y-R-E. So what lines are a mixture. The thin lines are on the, you know, arms above the mourners' heads, and the thick lines are on the shields and the funeral pyre. The rhythm is obvious, repeated shapes. It's particularly strong on the spaghetti legs, is what my daughter called it when she first saw this slide when she was like five. Those are really poorly done. The technique for space is, well, there's some overlapping, but it's really almost childlike is what I'm trying to say. It clearly wasn't one of the more skilled artists at that time in Athens who painted this, but even so, they didn't have very many sophisticated artists that far back. This is, remember, archaic. That's that early period I just mentioned, when the artwork wasn't very sophisticated or very highly skilled. You can see that, the evidence of that. So the only technique is a little bit of overlapping these shields, which almost look like half-eaten apple cores, are supposed to overlap the body of the soldiers, and then the horses are supposed to be three side by side overlapping. The largest mass, there is no larger or smaller mass. It's too hard to say. They're almost all the warriors here are the same size, and the shields and the horses are the same. Okay, and each scene is balanced if you drew a line down the middle and left to right. Obviously, the rhythm is powerful with the repeated shapes of the warriors and the horses and the shields. And then we have the color is warm brown, and they call it red, but it's really kind of an orange color. There's no cool colors here. Okay, we're going to do one more, and that'll take us up to a break. That's another view of the same piece. You could probably see it was cracked when they found it and they had to restore it, but that's actually the original piece, not recreated. Okay, so this is Dionysus in a boat. So we'll be literally halfway through with this one, and we'll take a break right about on time, maybe a tad before 8. Dionysus in a boat. That's D-I-O-N-Y-S-U-S. Dionysus in a boat. The architect, the artist, right? We know his name now. So if you put Greece, you wouldn't get credit for that part. That points off. It's whatever's on the syllabus, right? But of course you'll have an open book, open syllabus, open note test. Ezekias was this painter's name, E-X-E-K-I-A-S. The date is 540 BC. Ezekias is considered the first great classical Greek vase painter. Classical Greek vase painter. That would mean that he was more skilled, of course, than the archaic vase painter that we just saw. That should be obvious when you look at it, but if it isn't, you'll see as we go along. So what does this tell? It tells the origin myth. It tells the story, the painting, the scene inside this shallow bowl-like vase. That's what a calyx is. It's a kind of vase where K-A-L-I-X, you'll have to know the definition. It's not on your list of terms, but just part of the meaning. This is a very shallow vase where you put it on a table and you put things, sometimes just flowers or, you know, fruits, vegetables, you know, bread, whatever, both for use or consumption and just for display. So you wouldn't carry large quantities of things. It's not that big or deep. So we're looking down into it. It should be obvious, right? From above. So this is the boat on which Dionysus, anybody know who he was? He's an ancient Greek god of, anybody?
Madness.
Of what?
Wine and madness.
Yeah, it's interesting. You say, oh, that's an original, the second term. Yeah, you could say it that way. Definitely the ancient Greek god of wine, and some would say of partying or debauchery and madness. That's very creative. You could just keep it simple, say what everyone agrees on is he was the one word no one would dispute, the ancient Greek god of wine, among other things. Okay, and that's what this shows, the origin of wine and dolphins. It's two origin myths in one painting. So what happened? Here's the story. There's no other way to explain this, but to tell you, just keep it to maybe a paragraph. Dionysus, as like all great Greek gods, ancient Greek gods, was 50 feet tall. But he disguised himself as a normal human being and came down to Earth. And he was kidnapped by pirates. They took him to sea on their boat, and he told them who he was. They laughed, and so he decided to turn himself into his full height and knocked all the pirates off the boat into the water. That's what's happening. So when he saw them drowning, supposedly, this is really strange, he took pity on these pirates, even though they kidnapped him, and turned them into dolphins so they wouldn't drown. So that's how dolphins were created. Who knew dolphins were once pirates? Yeah, or descended from pirates. The other origin myth is wine itself. He was thirsty. It was a hot day, no shade. So he turned the mast into giant bunches of grapes, which then fermented in the sun. He squeezed them, voila, wine. Okay, so it's really, it's typically Greek strange myth about how both dolphins and wine were first created. So it's a double origin myth, both of which were created by Dionysus on this one strange outing that he had down on Earth. The Greek gods were always coming down to Earth, you have to write this, and messing with humans. It's constantly, well, you know, heroes were part of what they left behind was, you know, a human that would be impregnated, or sometimes it was, you know, the gods, the female gods or goddesses would then become pregnant by a human if they chose to. So they came down and interacted in different ways with humans according to Greek myths, and this is one of those. Okay, anybody need me repeating part of that? So we're going to be able to take our break in about 3 or 4 minutes, because I do want to do the formal elements here. We have warm colors everywhere, orange and brown, except on the sail. Of course, that's cool. Here there is simulated texture, I think, on both his, I don't know what these are. They're either trouser bottoms, a blanket, or pajama bottoms. But that's supposed to be his, you know, knees and his legs bent, you know, as he's stretching out on this little boat that he's as, almost as long as the boat. So I see simulated texture on that, whatever you want to say, covering, you can call it that, or blanket, or legging. And then on his crown, which he has for some reason, a crown, I'm not sure why, and beard. So there's some simulated texture, but definitely I see it on the grapes. But there, and even on the boat. So there is simulated texture, you know, on the wooden, you know, railing on the boat. But there's no modeling here. None. It's obviously full of rhythm. The repeated shapes of the dolphins, the grape bunches, and the patterns on the boat decorations, and of course on his body, arms, and then those stars. That's what they look like to me. Well, they are almost on his, I would say, pajama bottoms or whatever you want to say. So there's lots of rhythm. It is almost entirely dynamic. The only thing stable is the mast, and even that turns dynamic. So everything else is curved. The largest mass is the boat. Then it's a close call, maybe the sail and then him. For space, there's just overlapping. The mast overlaps the sail, and the boat overlaps Dionysus. And of course, the rhythm is very strong with the repeated shapes of the grape bunches, the dolphins, his arms and legs, the boat railing. And then let's see, we texture, I already mentioned. Oh, line, yeah, here the line is painted. And it's a mixture of bold. I would say the dolphin's line is bold and thin on his body. And then on the boat, it's some of both. The lines on the front, on the railing are thin, and on the prow, they're thick. So it's a mixture. Okay, and of course, I already mentioned the color. So I think we've covered everything. Texture, balance, is it roughly balanced? Yes, it is, because the boat's in the middle and the sail almost bisects the whole thing. And there's a roughly equal number. Although there are four grapes here, this, yeah, it's roughly balanced. But if you want to be technical, you could say some of you may feel, and I wouldn't argue, that it's somewhat unbalanced toward the left. But to me, the boat, more of the boat is on the right side. So I think it's pretty roughly balanced both ways, top to bottom and left to right. Okay, let's take our break. All right. And let's make it, how about 18 minutes? So one of two things will happen. If we don't have time for me to show you my own slides, then we'll do that maybe next week of Santorini, the beautiful Greek island. That's the source for the legend of Atlantis. Or if we don't have time, we'll just end a little early. But if we do have time, it's optional, of course, I would show them and still end maybe a couple minutes early. All right, well, now it's 7:53. So how about if we start again at 10 after? Okay, is that right? Let's see. I'm going to do pause recording. We'll see you guys about 10 after 8. Okay, here we go. The second half of ancient Greek art. Well, Minoan and Greek art. These are the periods that Greek art, ancient Greek art, is divided into. I already mentioned archaic, the earliest period, the least skilled or developed period of ancient Greek art. Now, Mycenae as a city predates 800 BC, but their painting and sculpture usually is considered archaic from 800 to about 500. And then classical, which is what we're going to spend most of this next session on, is their most famous, when the most famous Greek art and architecture was created. And that's roughly 500 to 350. And then Hellenistic is the last period, and I'll define that. That's from Alexander the Great's father, who conquered Greece. He actually wasn't Greek, by the way, but he spoke Greek. And his army was Greek. So Hellenistic is from about 350 to about 150 BC. And then the Romans came in and took over everything. Okay. The terms, the list of terms you know, include, as you see from that list, a pediment. I'll define them when we get to them. A portico and a base. This is not the greatest drawing of a Greek temple, but you get the general idea. The three main segments. There are a lot more details. We used to make people memorize in the art history department. They would be tested on the midterm of 20 or more terms for all the details on a Greek temple and what style it was of column on each one. That's more detail than we require now. And then this is the island we're going to see, Santorini, if time permits, where the Minoans, one of their main islands, and the town, the only decent-sized town, is called Thera, and it's a modern town. But sorry, I didn't catch that because I was holding that up. Somebody want to repeat that? Was that a question? I didn't see it.
I was just wondering, when was the last time, when was the time period for the last vase, the Zacchaeus vase?
Zacchaeus vase, that? That's a good question. Excellent question. And it's a good segue. That vase predates classical, but it's true of all human societies, right? That there's always a few people, artists, they're often those who are ahead of their time, right? So I think that's what you're referring to. It sounds like you caught on to that. The date of that would be late archaic if it was just strictly numerical, but like all movements of a culture, right? Of music, of art, architecture, literature. Yeah, some people are ahead of the curve. So Zacchaeus, that's why we call him the first great, yeah, I see the question there. The first great classical sculptor, vase painter, sorry. And that's because he was, a couple decades or more, like three or four decades ahead of the rest of the majority of the Greek vase painters, didn't get as skilled as he was until around 500. By which time any successful, competent Greek vase painter would have had to have those skills, but not before him. He was the only one. Yeah. So he was ahead of his time. Good point. Okay. All right. Let's try the screen share again. I don't know if this will work because I usually don't do it this way. Yeah, I think we're going to be all right. Yeah. Okay. You guys can see this, right? That's another view of it. Yeah, this is this should be obviously the replica. This is how it would have looked when it was brand new. And this is not one that's a must know, but I love this. The same guy, Zacchaeus, is a little later, about 520 BC. And here's Ajax and Achilles, two of the main warriors that were heroes during the Trojan War. They didn't, I don't think either of them died. I don't think so. playing, well, Achilles did, right? Ajax and one survived and Achilles didn't, sorry. They're playing checkers during a lull in the fighting. That's by Zacchaeus. It's a different kind of vase. See how skilled the quality of the painting was, right? Okay, this is the next must know. It's a one word title. Kouros, K-O-U-R-O-S. The location is Athens and the date is 525 BC. So on that point you just raised, it's a good timing for your question, that last question. This is late archaic. And here's the point, that in vase painting, you had one, maybe other people in Ezekias's workshop who were ahead of the time. You know, his staff or his assistants might have known how to paint better than other archaic painters. But with sculpture, that didn't happen. It took until after 500 for a sculpture to become more skilled and realistic. In other words, become classical style. So this is an archaic sculpture. It's a kouros, so that's your first definition now. So we have a few now all together at the end here. So let me give them to you in order. Kouros, right? K-O-U-R-O-S is the title of this slide, but it's also a separate term. So here we go, is, I'll say it slowly and repeat it once, a life-size sculpture of an ancient Greek male, comma, a life-size sculpture of an ancient Greek male, comma, usually of an athletic or military victor, sorry, it's got three parts, usually of an athletic or military victor, right, won something, comma, and sometimes, I would underline that word, sometimes, not always, sometimes placed above their grave after they died, you know, decades later, unless they died young. Almost always, these were of young men in the prime of their health, their physical health. Because to win a battle, right, or to win an athletic contest, and by definition, you're not going to be, you know, very, very elderly and near the end of your life. So that's what a kouros would have been. It would have been to celebrate the victory of a young, usually very, you know, fit male, Greek male. And then maybe if after that person died, it could be 50, 60, you know, years, decades later, whenever they died, that family, the descendants, might have chosen to put it over their grave, but it wasn't a gravestone. You follow that, right? Sometimes they were used that way, but I think maybe less than half the time. In any case, this one, as far as we know, wasn't used as a gravestone. It's in a museum in Athens. So why is this archaic? Well, the musculature, the anatomy, you could say it that way, the anatomical correctness, however you want to write that, is superb. It's excellent. You know, all the details on the body, but that's not what makes it archaic. It's the stiff two things that mark this as archaic style sculpture. Okay. Both would be present on any archaic sculpture. First, the stiff, formal, unlifelike pose or unnatural, say. Yeah, there we go. Stiff, lifelike, and I'll have to say it over again. I apologize. A stiff, formal, unnatural pose. You could say unlifelike. That was a word I was looking for, because people don't stand like this in real life. Who stands like that? It's all of the archaic sculptors use this pose, the kouros pose. But there's an even more obvious way in which it's not realistic. The archaic smile, they call this. I call it the thousand-yard stare. I mean, look at his face. The eyes aren't realistic at all. It looks like he's in a trance, hypnotized, you know, just not really functioning. And the smile in the face, the overall expression, I mean, in the face, the whole thing, it's called an archaic smile by historians. They didn't use that word back then, of course, is not lifelike at all. So you can say an unemotional, unlifelike expression called the archaic smile. That's the second feature, okay? That marks this as archaic style. There's no question, neither the pose nor the expression on the face are lifelike or realistic. They could almost have interchanged the heads of these people, right? Because, you know, they might vary their hairstyle or maybe the size of their ears or something. But anyway, they weren't actually very realistic portraits of individuals. They didn't need to be. They weren't meant to be. There is one more fact about this, that perfect physique on a human body in ancient Greek, sorry, let me rephrase it. In ancient Greek sculpture, right? Whenever a human figure was shown in the nude, male or female, with supposedly, again, by their standards, quote, perfect physiques. If they were depicted with, well, this guy would qualify in a Greek, you know, classical setting as having a perfect physique, you know, muscular and, you know, obviously fit. Then that is a sign that gods favored that person. They believe that was part of their religious belief. It was an actual religious, sort of tradition to have the sculptures of these people if they were supposedly, well, if you just won a big victory in battle or in an athletic contest, then you would probably attribute it to the gods, right? The gods favored me. That's why I won. So now I get the sculpture made of me and my body will be shown to be perfect. The physique will be perfect because that is a sign that the gods favor me. It's almost like a self-fulfilling prophecy if you think about it. The other phrase is circular logic. Some of you know from critical thinking. Yeah, but it is a belief, a religious belief, very strongly held throughout ancient Greek art, all the way from the early archaic through the late Hellenistic and then on into the Romans. They did that too. Yes, Samuel. Go ahead.
So the hair looks like it's braided rather than like dreadlocks.
It's dreads. Yes, it is. The ancient world, they did that quite a bit. And that, from all the way from, of course, some parts of Egypt, some of the people in the upper classes anyway, who could afford to have their hair style, and Babylon, all the way through the Minoans and the Greeks. The Romans didn't do it that much. Basically, they did too. Sometimes the Romans did too.
I could imagine that the carving the hair was probably very tedious.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you had to be. Yeah, this was a top, probably made by one of the top sculpture studios, or where they call them workshops, because they turned out dozens of these things every month. They had to make a decent income. Okay, formal analysis is pretty easy on this one. Completely stable, except the top of the head. And of course, it's a human body that's intact. So completely balanced, left to right, top to bottom. The rhythm is obvious with the two hands, right? Two arms, two legs, two feet, the face. The Simeon texture is good on the musculature, on the hands and the feet and the face. And that's, of course, all of the Simeon textures are done with carved line. Now, there is some evidence, strong evidence, that many of the ancient Greek sculptors were originally painted, some bright colors even, or realistic skin tones and things. We don't know for sure if there's no evidence left on the statue, but some statues have little flecks of paint left on them, so we know some of them were painted, but this one we don't know, so we'll just assume it was a cool gray color. And again, of course, I already said the cement texture is really good on the hair, right? And that's all carved line. There's no technique for modeling because, of course, it's in a museum, so it's just the lighting from the museum. Let's see, it's a single mass. There's no larger or smaller mass. And for space, it's a life-size figure of about 6 feet tall. That would have been taller by far than the average Greek male at that time. So it's real space. And I don't know if I even see overlapping. Maybe the hair overlaps the forehead, I guess. Okay, am I forgetting anything? Carved line, balance, rhythm. Yeah, I think that's it. All right. This is not, I used to have this on the, yes, go ahead.
I think if I just ask a question about that, because when I first saw that slide of Horus, I was just curious about his legs. Like, what are the lines? Is that just?
You mean down here?
Yeah, like it looks like, is that supposed to be the shin or is it?
Yes,
like
it is. Yes, it's the shin.
Ah.
And it's just a carved line. No, it's an interesting thing. Yeah, it looks like he got stuck with, the protruding part of a spear or an arrow or something, right, in the leg. I know I've had students say that. No,
yeah, it's really exaggerated.
It's in Athens.
It kind of looks like somebody stuck like a reinforced piece on there. And if you like, also I noticed if you like, could can be. You move it down towards like the ankles?
Yeah.
There seems
yeah.
like
yeah, oh, like, yeah, yeah. I was gonna say this piece has had to be restored. So many of them have, not as much as some of them, but you'll see that's even more so when we get to the spear bearer, the most important slide for the second half of tonight. But there's two that are so important, I definitely won't cut them to the stay list. I'm not including this on that high probability list. But again, as you know, it could still be on the midterm. Yeah, no, it's that's actually just the discoloration of the edge of what's supposed to be the shin of the lower leg there. Yeah. But yeah, I know it's kind of odd. But this piece is, there are hundreds of them all over every museum in Greece, but you can go to the Getty Museum in Malibu, right, Southern California, and you'll see a room full of these. At least you used to. I don't think they've closed that section. Okay, this is a core A. You don't have to write this, not on the syllabus. I took it off. I like this one because here we know she was painted because we can see patterns of the dress, colors on her dress, and her hair had henna. Everyone knows what henna is, right? The color of henna, and of course it's in dreads. She's missing the end of one arm. But my favorite thing is that look. I call it the Prozac just kicked in look there on her face. I mean, that's the thousand yard stare is the other phrase for that. Obviously it's called the archaic smile for a reason, because it's not the way most people look at you unless they're in a slightly altered state of mind. Okay, so you can ignore all that. But not this one. This is one that's really important, high up on the list of probable slides for the midterm. The next must know, of course. And the title of this is Spear Bearer, just like it sounds, two words, Spear Bearer. And the artist's name, the sculptor is one word, Polykleitos, Polykleitos, P-O-L-Y-K-L-E-I-T-O-S, Polykleitos, 450 BC. Now, let's start with the fact that this is a Roman copy of an earlier Greek original sculpture. And as per the point a couple of you raised on the last slide, it was heavily restored. In fact, all of the white bands are concrete used to hold the pieces together because it was found in, you know, broken pieces underground, of course. It had been buried for, well, more than centuries, probably thousands of years. So it's a Roman copy of an earlier Greek sculptures, but we're giving you the information for the original piece because we know it was so famous. It was copied all over first ancient Greece and all their colonies. You know, they had a bunch of colonies. They had an empire even before Alexander the Great. And then the Romans obviously had a huge empire. So they had copies of this in the Roman Empire, but there were copies made even before that by the Greeks themselves. So we know the original piece looked like this. So why is it so important? Because here's what you should be writing about why this is a really important piece, very influential, a seminal, I've used that word, I think, right? Seminal, just like it sounds with an S, seminal work of art. It changed the course of sculpture. This piece was created by the first great classical sculptor. So it's two things. That would be, of course, Polykleitos. It was created by the first great classical Greek sculptor, and you can't say for sure exactly the first, but we'll say one of the first sculptures to use contrapposto. Boy, that term is definitely coming up in more than one place on the midterm. Very important definition that some of you may know if you read your Stockstead. I think that she gives a definition there, but I don't think it's as clear. You know, my definitions, I've developed them over decades, literally, and through different times when we use different art history texts earlier, and also just from my own art history classes I took, both at graduate and undergraduate level, and try to make it more simple and clear here. Okay, so here we go. This isn't the same as the definition, and most of these you've noticed are somewhat different than the ones in the glossary, so you should be writing them as I give them to you so it's clear when they come up how they work, what they mean. So what is contrapposto? It's in the middle of the page. For ancient Greek terms to know in tonight's lecture. Okay, contrapposto was a pose for sculptures invented by the ancient Greeks. I'm sorry, it's a long definition. You can't shorten it. maybe a little. Again, a pose for sculpture invented by the ancient Greeks with three features. One arm is down and the other is raised, usually holding something. You see he's holding a spear, what's left of it, or this may be a replacement of where the old spear that probably was metal and it rusted away when it was found. The spear is probably gone. So I'll say it again. First feature, one arm is down, the other is raised, usually holding something. Okay. The second and most important part of this definition, which actually Stockstead emphasizes, and in that regard, I agree with her, the most important of the three features, is that the weight is on the back leg and the front leg is loose. This knee and the upper leg all the way till you get to their shins is in front of this leg. I had someone argue with me over and over, and I understood. I don't mind that people want to dispute or disagree, debate, whatever word you want to use, as long as it's done respectfully. But there's no question that when you look closely at this piece, I've seen it, it's in a museum in Italy, you realize that that is the definition of the pose, or the second feature, of the pose, which is that, I'll say it again, the weight is on the back leg. Not left and right, has nothing to do with left and right. So don't make that mistake. You'd get that wrong if it's on the exam. The weight's on the back leg and the front leg is loose. He's not putting weight on this. He's lifting his foot up here. That's how people really stand. The point is, this is the most realistic pose ever invented. No one's improved on it in 2,500 years. It's the most lifelike realistic pose. And the third feature of contrapposto is the spine forms a gentle S curve. The spine actually would be from here. Sorry. It forms a gentle S curve. This is how people really stand. And if it's not obvious, you would add to this that classical sculpture, this is not about the pose now, but about the style of this piece, shows realistic human emotion and expressions. Clearly, this is a man getting ready to go either into battle or into combat of some kind, you know, athletic combat, whatever, contest, if you want to write it that way. He's gathering his strength. And you can see that there's a realistic expression, lifelike human expression on his face, not that thousand yard stare we saw on the Kouros pieces. So that's another aspect of what marks this as classical. But everybody got that full definition of contrapposto? Anybody need me to repeat part of it? It's pretty important. It will come up probably in two different sections of the midterm, either this as a slide that you would analyze or on definitions section. I'll explain how to study for the exam, of course. You've got a few weeks before we go there. Okay, and then the final thing is this same thing about the last piece, the physical perfection, or the perfect physique, you can say it that way. Again, by the standards of ancient Greece. He has a perfect physique, which what symbolizes, remember, that this man was favored by the gods, which is a religious belief of the ancient Greeks. So this man was favored, what, to win whatever contest he was in, or, you know, competition or battle. Okay, that's a pretty important combination of things that this symbolizes. And the sculptor Polykleitos would have then trained a whole generation of, that's why he's considered the first great sculptor of the classical era. First great classical Greek sculptor. Because he inspired, you know, generations of followers after him and all the way into the Romans. This is actually was done in the first century AD, 500 years after Polykleitos created the original. This copy was made, and it is in, I believe it's the Vatican, pretty sure that's it. In, basically Rome. It's, you know, within the city of Rome. You can just say it's in a museum in Italy, or if you want to say Rome, that's fine. Okay, plenty on the meaning here. So let us do a formal analysis. Well, here you could debate this one. Is it cool or warm? Well, on the lower half from about the top of the thighs down, it looks warm because it's discolored. It's been underground for centuries. But the original color of the stone was what the chests, pecs, I guess, right? And the arms and the face look like. It was a cool gray color. But because it's discolored, you could say it's both now. The bottom half is mostly warm and the upper half is mostly cool. Of course, there's carved line to create the cement texture on the face, the eyes, the hair, the muscles. The fig leaf was added later, by the way, if you're curious, by probably a pope or someone in the Catholic Church anyway, because of course that was, you know, controversial back in the 18 or early 1900s. A lot of ancient Greek and Roman sculpture in the Vatican museums were covered, the private parts were covered with fig leaves. Is pretty silly, but for whatever reason, that's still there now. Okay, and then we have the rhythm, of course, of the two arms, two hands, two legs, and the face. It's a single mass, not really. When you break it, you can break it down, because here you have a tree stump right behind him, and you have a spear. So I would say the largest mass is him, then the tree stump, and then you could say the base. That's original, by the way. It was originally on a base. Not all the Greek sculptures were. So is it the base, the third largest, or the sphere? Well, when the sphere was new and complete, intact, you know, like 8 feet long, it would have been the third largest mass. For space, it's a life-size figure about 6 feet tall. And here we have overlapping of the hand over the sphere. And you could say the right leg over the tree stump. Well, and the fig leaf, I guess, if you want to add that. And then we have balance. Well, it's a human body and it's standing upright and it's intact. So of course it's balanced left to right and top to bottom. And then it's both stable and dynamic because the legs are mostly stable, at least the leg that weights on, and the one arm that's down, even the raised arm is also mostly stable. But you'd have to say it's dynamic, slightly dynamic on the right S curve of the spine and the top of the head. So it's some of both. All right, let's see. Modeling horses, shadows from the museum. And I already mentioned the simiad texture, I think. Well, maybe I didn't there. We'll wrap it up with that. That's obviously carved line on the face, on the hair and the muscles. And that's all simulated texture. There's no painted line here. We don't know if this piece might have been painted when it was new. All right. This is the second of the second half for this second half tonight of the really, really important slides. It has a high possibility of being on the final. It should look familiar to some of you, not just because you hopefully read about it in Stockstead, but it's a pretty famous building, even though it's in partially in ruins. Parthenon, P-A-R-T-H-E-N-O-N, P-A-R-T-H-E-N-O-N. The architects, and yes, they were two, they were a team or a, you know, partnership. Callicrates and Ictinos. I'll spell those slowly for you. A K-A-L-L-I. K-R-A-T-E-S, Callicrates and Ictinos, I-K-T-I-N-O-S, 432 BC. Why is this such an important? Well, there's no question this is a seminal work of art in every sense of the word. So why do we say that? It influenced the style of Greek temples after this for hundreds of years, Greek and Roman temples. So what is it about it that makes it a prototype is really the best word, right? A prototype of all classical Greek temple architecture. And when we say that, we mean all the way until today, because if you haven't noticed or had reason to notice, there are Greek temple design buildings all over the world. Every continent has some public and some private, even, you know, residences, mansions. I mean, you don't have to have seen Clueless, right? Where the main character walks up to, it does look like a Greek temple in Beverly Hills. But yes, in Beverly Hills, there are plenty of houses that are inspired by this. But the point is, for public buildings, that's just limited to public buildings, this became the prototype for Greek and Roman temples for over 1,000 years, right? We're talking about 400 BC, 5th century BC. The Romans didn't fall until the 5th century AD, so you're looking at almost 1,000 years in which this style held sway throughout the Greek, they call it Greco-Roman, you've heard that phrase, world, this style, which is a classical Greek temple style. So what does that mean? First of all, it meant total bilateral symmetry, or is it actually, it's an optical illusion, and that's part of the meaning of why this style, this temple set the style, I'm sorry, for all Greek and Roman temples afterwards, all classical style temples. So wait a minute, it looks symmetrical, right? Well, it is and it isn't. So I don't know any other way to explain it, but just follow me here and I'll summarize it. The placement of the columns is uneven, but the space between them, of course, but that's just the short way to say it. The placement of the columns is not evenly, so they are not evenly spaced, because the human eye would see it as unequal or not evenly spaced. If it was actually spaced evenly, there's no other way to explain it. It's a human eye, you know, quality of human vision or limitation, whatever phrase you want to use, just the way humans perceive space. on large-scale structures. So what did they do? These two architects, they were geniuses. They came up with a mathematical equation. I'm not going to go into it. I don't even know how to, you know, summarize it. So just keep it simple and say that they came up with a way of placing the columns from, you know, the middle of the temple out toward the edges at slightly different spacings so that they looked evenly spaced. It does work, because when you stand there, you'd never guess that. No one would ever guess that if they look at this. I've heard tour guides, I've been to Athens several times, and they'll ask people that question, you know, the English speaking ones, and people say, aren't they evenly placed? Oh, of course they are. Yeah, it's a Greek temple, it has to be. No, there's you know, I don't know if it's a foot more or less in between. It doesn't matter the details. What matters is the concept. So I'll repeat that these two architects came up with a way of placing the columns at uneven spacing between them so that they looked evenly spaced to the human eye. It's brilliant. No one had ever thought of that before. And then the other thing that marks it, so that is called, whoops, I didn't finish my next definition. Sorry, that's an important one. These are short ones. And that's portico. Portico, which is on your list. I don't have to spell it on your list of terms. Very short definition. It's a columned, right? Columned porch across the front of a Greek or Roman temple. Now that's in the ancient world. It could mean something different, like the White House has porticos, right? But we're just doing stuff from the syllabus now. The definitions apply to what we're covering in this class. I'll say that again. A portico is a columned, with an ED, porch across the front of a Greek or Roman temple. So the portico has unevenly placed columns. And that is the genius, if you want to call it, or brilliance of how this building was designed. And then the last new definition is pediment. And again, that's on your list of terms. I don't have to spell it for you. A pediment, again, a short definition, is a triangular enclosure around the gable end. That's the gable, right? The end of the roof is the gable. I'll say it again. A triangular enclosure around the gable end of a Greek or Roman temple. So I'm going to give you a better, see, it's been so badly damaged because it's been abused. This building has been through all kinds of things. I'll tell you why it's in semi-ruin in a minute. But just so you know what it looked like, I'm lucky I found this slide. This is in Nashville, Tennessee, here in the good old USA. That's how this building looked. It's a replica of the actual original appearance of the Parthenon. So the pediment was used to put sculptures of different Greek gods and goddesses. And then these columns are definitely placed, spaced, I mean, unevenly, so that they look even. Okay, whoops, that's another view of it from across the lake. Let's focus on this slide. Of course, is the one you'll see if it's on the exam. So what's important about this now, the other part of it is, what was the temple for? Besides the style, that's obviously very important. I already covered all that you need to know about why it's considered a prototype for classical Greek temples. The other part is, what was it for? It was to house a statue of Athena, the goddess who protected Athens. Of course, the city took its name from her. Again, the goddess Athena, right, ending in an A, for whom Athens was named. A statue of her was placed in the back of this temple. It was 50 feet tall, just like they thought all their gods were. Made out of gold and ivory, if you can imagine that. You don't have to write that detail, but you could write it if you want to as part of the meeting. That disappeared sometime around the fall of Rome or something, you know, but it was there for hundreds of years. So this was a temple dedicated to Athena, the goddess, the ancient Greek goddess of wisdom, and the protector goddess of Athens, both. So that's why they built a temple in her honor, to worship her and put a statue of her in the back. Now, why is it in semi-ruin? That's the other part of the meaning of the last part. Because the Turks, who occupied Greece for centuries, the Turkish Empire, right? When they had an empire, and it was a big one, they didn't respect the countries that they occupied. There's no debating that. Modern Turkey is a different situation. But back then, they would do whatever they wanted in those countries. So when they occupied Greece, they stored their army, stored gunpowder. Can you believe it? Barrels of gunpowder inside this temple. Why would you do that, right? Well, guess what? One day, an accident, we think it was an accident, nobody knows for sure, caught those barrels ignited, there we go, ignited the gunpowder, and it blew the roof completely off of the temple, and it knocked down about a third of the columns. So that's why the pediment's not complete. But there's one last bit of meaning here, and it's kind of an unfortunate, tragic side effect of, well, colonialism, what else could you call it? When the British helped the Greeks kick the Turks out of their country, they helped them get their country back. They got their independence from the Turkish Empire with the help of the British. The commanding, or just say a British general, his name is Lord Elgin, you don't have to know his name, stole all of the statues that were on here, except one little section, that's all. I don't know why he left that, but you can see what they would have been. Beautiful collection of all the major Greek gods and goddesses, including Athena, there she is, in her armor, you know, defending Athens against attack, which, by the way, Athens was attacked a whole bunch of times in its ancient history. So all of the sculpture that was there, that survived the explosion of the Turkish gunpowder placement. And yet they were stolen by a British general and taken back to London, where they're still for over 200 years. They've been on display in the British Museum, and the Greeks are still mad. I don't blame them. They are demanding them back, but the British government won't return them. So that's plenty of facts about the meaning. Remember, you don't have to remember everything. Well, I don't know if I've said this, but the exam is a one-hour exam. And you don't have to write more than two paragraphs on both formal. We'll cover all this. It's a few weeks from now, but just so you don't get too concerned, you aren't going to have to recall everything I'm telling you on each slide about the meaning or all of the nine elements composition. I give them to you so you have them in your notes. I'll tell you how to study the exam and what not to waste your time on so you have more efficient use of your time. Plus, it is an open book, open note test, of course, as is the final. Okay, let's wrap up this one with a formal analysis. It is symmetrical in the sense that the difference in the spacing of the columns is the same from left to right. So in that sense, it is a symmetrical building. In any case, it visually appears to be, so you would just say it has an overall symmetry left to right, and I would say top to bottom. Because the base, which is the stairs, right, which go all the way down to here, by the way, you can't see them because it's cluttered with all these broken stones from all the invasions. Athens has been invaded many times. But in any case, the pediment, right, and the stairs, or base, you could just say base, are about equal in mass. So it's balanced, I would say, both ways. If you draw a line across the middle of the columns, top to bottom and left to right. Of course, there's the rhythm, repeated shapes of the columns, and there was of the sculpture when it was all there. Now there's still a little bit of decorative, these are mostly animals, right? In that frieze, it's called a frieze below the pediment. You don't have to know that word, but that creates rhythm. The columns individually do, the steps, of course. And when it was new, the gods, the sculptures or statues of the gods created rhythm. It's almost entirely stable. The only thing dynamic about it really is the pediment. The sculpture would have been, but it's gone now. The color is the real warm yellow. What looks like it is, that's the actual color. It's a beautiful color, yellow marble, which marble usually is not, of course. That's a rare color for marble. So that makes it warm. Modeling is the shadows created by the sun. There is carved line. There was on all the pediment sculpture, but there still is in this area. Well, the right word is frieze. That's F-R-I-E-Z-E. You don't have to write that. You can say the decorative panels. They're carved line in that. And on the columns, each column, right, has these ridges. So that's all carved line. And then there's a visual line at the corners. The texture is the real smooth texture of marble. And then simulated texture is not really, I wouldn't even, you could say this piece here, but there is, you can sort of see it's two nude male figures. So there's some simulated texture, but it's barely visible, you could just say. It's almost all what's visible in this photo is almost entirely real smooth texture of the stone. Okay, for space, it was several rooms. It's a long rectangular building with a 55-foot high ceiling. Because they had to get the 50-foot statue into it and move it to the back, which had several rooms, a long rectangular building with a 55-foot high ceiling. and one large room at the back, which held the statue of Athena. Okay, any questions? All right, let's move on to, this isn't a must know, but I think it's interesting because what you see here is another one of the five temples. The Parthenon is only one of five temples on the Acropolis. And I will mention that word when we get to the meaning for your notes on the next must know, but for now you can just listen. This actually is more relevant than it was a week ago when I showed this slide to my other ancient art history class. They're a week ahead of you guys, right? Because it started on Wednesday. I mentioned this without realizing it was going to become a prophetic statement. These are the original Ukrainian warriors. I'm not stretching the facts whatsoever. You don't have to write it or remember it, but I think it's really interesting to know. These are the Amazons. The Amazons, which the word Amazon, forget the website. We're talking about the ancient meaning of the word Amazon before the river or anything else had that name, were a legendary, not mythical, they're real, legendary tribe of female warriors who kicked the butts of everyone who came and tried to conquer that part of what is now Ukraine. They were on the southern steppes of what today is Ukraine. They were fierce women warriors. They defeated the Greeks in battle many times, and the Greeks respected and admired them because of that. So here they have 8-foot tall statues of Amazon warriors acting as columns supporting the porch, right, of one of their temples. This was their treasury, where all the gold was kept and other valuables for the city treasury of Athens. So these are on every modern, or not every modern, but let's say late 19th, early 20th century, you know, from about 1890 to about 1930s. Every art museum I've seen in this country that uses classical style has these kinds of sculpture on them, these Amazon warriors. And if you care, oh, you have to know, this is not on your syllabus, but I'll just tell you your list of terms. They're called caryatids. I'm not sure the exact meaning of that, but I think it translates roughly into female warriors. They were very fierce. They weren't 8 feet tall, but they were taller than the average Greek woman. They were at least the same height as the Greek male warriors. So that's in a kind of an ironic, right, 2,500-year-old tip of the hat, however you want to say, a bit of honor towards a part of the world where I think we see the courage of Ukrainians right now in the modern world. All right, this is our next must know. And this is the, did I take this off? Yes, no, it's on here. Here it is, Temple of Athena Nike. So we're, you know what we're going to be able to do? I'm going to cut one of these slides, not this one or the last one, but the one above it. The order is slightly different. I've told you, I reserve the right to do that. We'll cut one of them. Why don't we do it now? Take your pens and cross off Young Warrior. Young Warrior, third from the bottom for tonight. I mean, we have enough statues of, you know, nude male Greeks in Contrapposto, right? You got the idea for that. So that means we're gonna have time for just, you know, 12, 15 minutes of my own slides, and still in a little early tonight. So that's good news. So one last slide, but let's go now to this one, second from the bottom. Temple of Athena. We already talked about her. A Nike, though, it's a different god. She's the assistant or companion. Most would say in ancient Greece, messenger for Athena. And she was only 5 feet tall. So this is her temple. Again, Temple of Athena Nike. Yes, it is the same spelling. And yes, it is the inspiration for the tennis shoe of that name. No question, they were inspired by this ancient Greek minor goddess. She was 5 feet tall. Athena was 50 feet tall. So the messenger could fit in the hand, the open hand. And there were many statues of the two of them together where Athena Nike was on the palm, resting on the palm of Athena. This temple was not to the big Athena. This is the original piece that was on the back wall of this temple, which would have been right here. They removed it because the pollution is so bad in Athens that it was eating away the stone on this panel of the illustration of course, the messenger for Athena, Athena Nike. She's here adjusting her sandal, getting ready to go down to earth, and, you know, land somewhere on earth, wherever Athena tells her to go deliver a message to humans on earth. That was her job. And you can see she had a perfect physique, and so this would have been another. And she is a god, a minor goddess, actually, goddess. So of course she would have been shown with the perfect physique, as was Athena and the other female goddesses or gods. That's redundant to say female goddess, isn't it? Now this is missing the pediment. You can see that, but otherwise it's almost intact, except for the back wall having the panel where the sculpture itself was removed because it was deteriorating. It's in a museum in Athens. And this is a much smaller temple. And it's on the hill called, this part of the meaning, Acropolis. That's actually a word some of you may have heard. It's a common name for a lot of Greek restaurants, for instance. It's the highest hill in Athens where all the main temples were. Acropolis, pretty much just like it sounds. A, of course, capital A-C-R-O-P-O-L-I-S, Acropolis. And this was one of those five most sacred temples on the Acropolis. And now you can see how the back wall would have been if it had the vitriol. And also get a hint of the pollution. This is a very old slide, it's not my slide. So, you know, much better as a newer one I found. This is, you know, pretty much intact with the exception of course, the roof is gone, the pediment, the roof. And then it was not disappeared or damaged, but removed deliberately by the Greek government, the sculpture of her in the back. Okay, that's pretty much the whole meaning. This is a different, this doesn't use that odd spacing because it's not big enough to need to do that. People wouldn't have trouble seeing if the columns were evenly spaced or not. So they really are. So again, formal analysis is pretty straightforward here. I'll do it quickly. These columns are evenly spaced, so it's symmetrical in every sense of the word, left to right. And I would say when the pediment was there, it clearly would have been. Again, you see the base is roughly the same area as the pediment would have been, which would have gone up to here, right? That's just the corners left. So originally it was balanced left to right and top to bottom. It's got the rhythm of the columns and what little bit of sculpture there is below the pediment and the steps. And there is carved line, although you can't see the sculptures here. You can tell they're human figures, or if it's not obvious, you can just write that. And so there's some carved line there. And the carved line is always on Greek columns. They always had ridges on them. And then we have, so there's no painted line. And it's cool gray color, because that other slide, that older one, is not accurate at all. This is the real color. There, the modeling, of course, is just the natural shadows from the sunlight. For space, it's one rectangular room with about a 12-foot high ceiling. Of course, the ceiling's gone, but originally it was a 12-foot high. So it's not a very large temple. Didn't need to be. And then we have the rhythm, of course, of the columns and the stairs and the carved figures on the frieze, or you could say below the pediment if you don't want to use that word. And then we have texture. It's real smooth texture of marble. The whole thing is marble. Some would say rough on the outer walls, I guess you could say, but the stairs and the columns are actually smooth marble. And then there's some cemented texture up there on those carved figures. And the lines all carved, I think, is it balanced? Oh, mostly stable. The only thing dynamic would have been the pediment, but that's gone now. Oh, the round shape of the column, sorry. So there's some dynamic detailing, but it's more stable because of all the shape of the building itself and the base and the tall upright columns is more definitely stable than dynamic. Okay. We're going to take a brief, not a break here, because we're not doing that. I'm going to skip over these because I want to get, you know, like I said, we can still end early, but I do want to show you what Atlantis might have looked like. This is a statue. I will just tell you what it is. You don't have to write. It's not on the syllabus. Of most people think it's Poseidon, the ancient god, or Neptune, the Romans called him, of the sea. And they would have been hurtling a trident, a three-pronged spear, at some target down in the water, or, you know, maybe across a river or something. He was a god of all the waters in ancient Greece and Rome. And this is the one I just cut, the young warrior. So you all cross that off, I hope, from your study list. You can see how, again, the physique is so perfect that he clearly would have been meant to be favored, or being indicated by that physique as being favored by the gods. Okay, so here we have, this is not a must know, but it segues into the last must know, which is important enough that I probably won't cut it from the list, the very last slide for tonight on the syllabus. This is a mosaic. We'll define what mosaics are when we get to a little later, in the, I think, 2 weeks from now, made up of pieces of glass. You don't have to know that for now, that term. Let's see. Am I going to put it on? I'm just double checking. Yeah, well, it depends on whether we get to Byzantine art. So I'm going to go ahead and take a look ahead. And no, that's for after the midterm. But it's just a kind of, two-dimensional work of art that has painted glass. Some of you already know what a mosaic is. This is a mosaic, not a fresco, of a battle, one of the most important battles in the history of the ancient world. Some would say of the world, period, because it's when Alexander the Great, that's him right here, who was kind of Greek. I mean, he was raised in Greek. He spoke Greek language. He was trained by Greek teachers, educated. But his father and his culture came from north of Greece. So we'll just say he was Greek. His army was Greek. So the Greeks, right, his army invaded the Persian Empire because it had always been the other way around. The Persians attacked the Greeks and they almost always left waste behind them. They destroyed the first three temples, or two at least, on the site of the Parthenon. The previous two temples to Athena had been destroyed by invading soldiers of the Persian Empire. So the Greeks decided to, repay them, I guess. And Alexander the Great won for the first time. He defeated the Persians in battle. No other Western commander had done that. And then he went on to, some of you know, this is the only time in the history of the Western world. There's some debate. You didn't say period, but certainly one of the handful of people, even if you want to stretch the definition, whoever conquered three continents in 10 years. That much he has a record for. 10 years, that's all he had as commander of the Macedonian/Greek army. He conquered parts of Europe, where he was based, but several other sections of what's now called the Balkans, southern Europe. Then he conquered this part of Asia, right? The Middle East, that's Asia, right? Where Israel is and Arabia. All the way down the Arabian Peninsula, and then he conquered Egypt and parts of North Africa, and then he turned east again, and he went all the way into India. Some of you know this. He conquered a section of India. Look how far that is from Greece. It's rather remarkable. Then here's the evidence for the fact that that culture is our last must-know. So now you do need to take the last set of notes for tonight. That this culture, the last phase, I should say, of Greek culture is called Hellenistic, was influenced. It was Hellenistic or late Greek art of all kinds. It's architecture, sculpture, painting, was influential throughout the Western world. They called it the known world. I mean, obviously there were people living in what's now England and Scotland that they didn't know about then. So Nike, here's the title of our last must know tonight. It's three words. Nike, just like the same spelling as this tennis shoe. Winged victory, three words, Nike, and I put winged victory in parentheses because it's often just called that by itself, those two words, winged victory. We have the location, we're not sure of the artist, so many people think they do know which sculptor did it, but we'll just give you the location. It's an island, the Greek island, Samothrace, one word, Samothrace, 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 190 BC. Or BC. So this is Hellenistic. I held that up, I know it wasn't that long, for you to maybe take note of it, but it's with two L's, like the name of, first name of someone named Helen. Hellenistic is the last phase of ancient Greek art, which was more detailed or decorative. It had two features. One is that it's more detailed and decorative than earlier classical Greek sculpture. And the second thing is it displayed a more intense emotional quality or component. The sculptures had a more intense emotional component or quality to them. Well, now this is a headless sculpture of the messenger. We already covered who she is, right? So you'd want to make sure if it's on the midterm that you'd say she was the messenger or assistant for Athena. And what she's doing here is landing on the prow of a boat. This is the front of a boat in which she has been ordered by Athena to go down to this boat and reward the sailors on that boat because they had won a victory in her honor. That is Athena's honor. So she was, you know, pleased with them for that, you know, prayed to her, and then she helped them win the victory. So she rewards them. What the reward is could be very, it could be gold, it could be, you know, jewels, it could be food feasts, it could be land, it could be happy marriages, you know, it could be whatever she chose. Athena was a goddess. She could make whatever she wanted happen down on earth. So this is the moment at which Athena Nike, her messenger, is just now landing on the prow of a Greek warship. So that's why it's called Winged Victory, the other name for it, because a lot of navies throughout the world, on just say different, in different parts of the world, I think it was over a dozen, used a version of this, a sculpture, as an image, you know, drawing of it, of course, we're saying a drawing of this sculpture, for their navies. Because it's symbolic of somebody winning a naval victory. The whole point is why it's nicknamed, the second name for it is Winged Victory. So it became very influential. Now, it's nowhere near where it was found. And once again, I assume it was Napoleon's soldiers. It was found on a Greek island named Samothrace, of course, and taken, stolen, however you want to say it, to Paris, which is where it is now. That's part of the meaning. It is now at the top of the grand staircase at the Louvre. When you go up that staircase, it's impressive to look up at this 2,200-year-old sculpture with her wings spread out, missing, it's true, the head, yes, but otherwise intact. And it's life size, meaning about the height of an adult woman in ancient Greece, about 5'5" or so. And her wings are outspread, so she is literally coming in for a landing. It's a very impressive piece. And you can see how the detail marks it as Hellenistic style. Look at the feathers. I don't know if any of you have ever held a bird in your hand, like my daughter and her second grade science class. One time I went with them on a field trip. We got to its Lawrence Hall of Science, actually touched the feathers of a bird. It's an incredibly soft texture. Look how realistic that bird-like, of course. There is no such thing as a winged goddess, but at least they thought there was such a thing back then. So it has what you would have to call super realistic texture and detailing on, including the robes. You notice how the wind is whipping around her legs. And then the emotional component would be the celebration, feeling of glory, if you want to put it that way, having won this battle, and satisfaction. But that would have shown on her face. We're sure that we've seen enough other, there's other sculptures of her that are intact at that same time in this style, Hellenistic, possibly even by the same sculptor. But anyway, the point is we have seen enough others in other museums where she's showing a smile and a happy expression. The intense emotion of victory, okay, is how that fits into Hellenistic style. Okay, that's the whole meaning. So let's do a formal analysis. Okay, this is life size. So for sculpture, for space, I mean, it is only overlapping is used here. She overlaps the prow of the boat. I don't know if that's original to the sculpture. It may or may not be. There probably would have been a base like this if this is a redo of it. The original base is probably like that. So she overlaps, her feet overlap the boat or the prow. Her clothes overlap her body, of course. And it's life size, about 5.5 feet tall. It's dynamic. There's not a straight line in it. And then, of course, I already said the semiotic texture is superb on the feathers of the, or you could just say wings, and on the robes. And that's all done with carved line. It's a cool gray color, though in this light it looks warm because of the museum lighting. So the modeling is just the shadows from the museum lighting. But originally it's a kind of a cool grayish color. Although it may look pink here, it's not the actual color. Let's see, carved line. Oh, balance, yes. Both her wings are out, her arms are stretched out evenly, and you know her body's intact, except for the head, of course. So I would say it's roughly balanced when it was new, of course, with the entire body up through the top of her head. Roughly balanced top to bottom because the legs spread out, and with the robes, it has a rough area of equal. Right, coverage of the wings and the legs. So I would say both left to right and top to bottom, it's balanced. Really, if the prow is original, you'd say there's two masses. Otherwise, it's one mass, just her. But if the prow is actually original, then that'd be the second largest mass. And we already covered carbine, the texture, right? I think that's everything. Oh, a stable or dynamic? Yeah, I already said it's stable. Now, let's do this and do this quickly because it's only 9:10. We're still going to end a few minutes or several minutes earlier. I'd like to show those of you who might someday want to. Let me ask, has anybody here been to any of the Greek islands? Anybody? Nobody tonight? Okay. Well, I hope sometime you'll be able to go. Of course, they had a really bad case of Omicron. They were shutting their, entry ports to a lot of foreign tourists, but they've opened them up again. So I'm going to go ahead and show you just for, 10 or 12 minutes or something like that, my own slides of Santorini. So let us go. There we go. Well, we'll start with this Greek island. Screen share. I always have to remember. You have to get it to where you got all the others. So give me just about 10 seconds to get down to where we can do. Here we go. Screen share. That should do it. Okay, can everybody see this? Yes?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is one of a series of Greek islands. I'll keep it brief till we get to Santorini. But if you take a ferry boat from the mainland of Greece, the only way to go between these islands is by ferry. And so, of course, you're going to not just go to one island. They're going to stop at a bunch of different islands and let people on and off. So that's what these first three or four slides are. But this was the most, this is Paros, one of the larger islands. It's way more populated than Santorini. Santorini only has a few tens of thousands of people, the whole island. Here there's probably, 100,000 or more in just the capital town. But it was under Turkish rule for a while, and the evidence of that is on that hill. That's a mosque up there, but we're going to go up closer just for a moment. This is the town hall in Renaissance style, with a kind of Greek temple front like Renaissance. And then there's a mosque. When the Turks ruled, they would put their mosque in any major Greek city, of course. But they didn't, one thing you have to say, they did not force the Greek population or try to force them to convert to Islam. So most Greeks are Christian, if they're religious at all these days, Greek Orthodox. Okay, here we go. This is an amazing place. This is where some people believe Atlantis, the legend of Atlantis may have come from. The island of Santorini. I think I did hold that up, but you don't have to worry about how you spell it. It's a one word name, and Santorini, T-O-R-N-I-N-I, is a volcanic crater left over from those explosions we were talking about earlier tonight when the Minoan culture disappeared and a series of huge volcanic eruptions occurred. And then of course, earthquakes followed by tidal waves, wiping out the Minoan culture within something of just weeks, others say months, in any case, within a short period of time. So this is actually what you're looking at here, the lip of a volcano. That won't quite register with most of you until you see a view of it from above in daytime, and you'll see what I mean. It's a remarkable sight. Okay, so we arrived at night, and we knew it would be boiling hot, and there's no shade, there's no trees on this island. So we decided, let's arrive at night, and you can find a nice place. That's the only town. Well, there are two towns, but the other one's really a village. So this town is where a lot of tourists stay, but we don't want to stay with, hotels where there's all kinds of modern rooms and things. So we stayed instead in a B&B, we'd call it, almost like Airbnb, but only you actually meet the owners. Very wonderful couple, elderly couple, spoke broken English. They cooked the food for us in the morning for breakfast. We stayed 3 days and nights. It was a wonderful experience. And walked into the town. So that's what we're doing here, taking a walk past volcanic stone construction. These buildings were constructed with volcanic rocks from their own shoreline or the crater that is the edge of the island itself. And then most of them have been plastered over and the plaster painted white. So when you walk down the streets of this island, when you get to at least some of the, well, that's the town. Actually, that slide is a little further down the road. And you look at some of the white stone, you get, I call this the island, my nickname for Santorini, it was the island of melting ice cream. It also reminds me of George O'Keeffe painting. Some of you know what I'm talking about. The Southwest American painter, one of the first famous women painters in America to get her own show and her own exhibits. It took till the early 1900s for women in America to do that. George O'Keeffe was the first one. She painted all kinds of Southwest Spanish era buildings that are stucco painted you know, pastel colors. This is an interesting phenomenon you see in different parts of the island. Some of the better, you know, whatever, well-off, more well-off families, more prosperous families, had their own crypts across the street from the entrances to their compounds. This is, you know, a gated compound leading into, you know, an extended family on that lives and has for generations on Santorini. And when one of their family members passes on, they go across the street and just open this gate and put Uncle Mordecai's body into his crypt or wherever, in the coffin or thing in there, and say their, you know, farewells and do their rituals and then lock it up again. So they had, some of these places had their own private crypts across the street. Most of them didn't, but those that did, it's really a local tradition. Okay, so let's now get closer to the town. And you begin to notice the streets. Yeah, that little boy wanted candy. I think I had something to give him. The church towers here are fascinating. They're multi-tiered, and they're different than any other Christian church of any other culture or style. They're Greek Orthodox, of course, but even for Greek Orthodox, this is unusual. And here's that, you know, painted white plaster. Of course, it's so hot with no shade, as you can see, no trees, that it helps to keep little bit of the heat away, of course, from inside the buildings. And here's a really interesting juxtaposition of three things. Here you've got imported, probably French Art Nouveau, maybe 100-year-old when I took it already. Now would it be about 130 or 40-year-old gates? Art Nouveau is a style invented in Paris that we're not going to cover in this class, but it's a beautiful French invention. And that's a French word, Art Nouveau. Those gates almost certainly weren't made on this island. There's no iron foundry, so they were imported probably from France. Then you have the volcanic rocks, thousands of years old from that explosion used to make the walls. And then above that, you have this another Greek Orthodox church with a multi-story or multi-tiered tower. And then you have some smaller ones on parts of the island, like this one, looking out over the Aegean Sea. Why, anybody here been in New Orleans? I guess not, right? Probably. It's funny, hardly anybody ever goes to New Orleans anymore since Katrina, I guess, the hurricane. Well, they bury their dead above ground in all their cemeteries, and that's the same here in many of the Greek islands, certainly all of Santorini's cemeteries. I saw three or four. Anybody guess why they bury their dead? They actually keep the crypts and the
part of it's because of the flooding, because the ground doesn't keep the caskets well. I used to work at a cemetery, so it's like really fun.
Which one?
Shiloh District Cemetery in Windsor.
Oh, in Windsor, yeah. Famous necropolis.
Oh, yeah.
In Santa Rosa, right? I think
it's Oh, I love them. I volunteer to clean the gravestones there.
Well, then you're right. This is because I hope that person can turn their mic off. Anyway, you're absolutely right. The bottom line here is that the water table is so high because you're on an island which doesn't have much thickness to the earth. So if they didn't do that, the bodies would float up. And if, speaking of Katrina, you don't know this, I'll bet, I don't know who that was that said you worked at a cemetery, but you may have heard this. After Katrina, the worst hurricane to hit the mainland over 100 years, bodies were pushed up below the cemeteries, out of their caskets in some cases, and floating either behind or in the Mississippi River.
Oh yeah, the disinterment of the dead after Katrina was just very tragic.
Yeah. Died, but many lifted up out of the dead. Okay, here we go. This is the main point I want to make. Look at what we're looking at. We're looking at the lip of a volcanic crater where this incredible explosion blew this whole, you know, city or whatever was there. The ancient one, obviously, this is a mere 500 years old. That's not very old in Europe, you know, or most of the rest of the world, right? The old world, we used to call it, versus, quote, the new world, the Western Hemisphere. Okay, so what we see here are buildings clinging to this hillside, some of the best wine and homegrown vegetables and home-cooked meals I've ever had. And the three nights we were there, we each night went to a different home-cooked cafe like on the hills. So that's one of the ways that people make money, besides the obvious general tourism, but, you know, as small restaurants. look at this. It's incredible. And now there's the best view. Look at that. That is the actual lip of a volcano, which 3,500 years ago, some say more like 3,300, so probably 33 centuries ago, blew its stack, completely wiping out all of the human inhabitation or inhabitants and almost every building, if not all the buildings on the island. And then the sea flooded in and created this lake. If anybody's been to Crater Lake in Oregon, it's similar to that, except that this is open at one end. I showed you that on the first slide. We just have a few more slides here. But it's pretty impressive when you look. Oh, by the way, real quick, see this boat here for scale? That's not some little yacht. That's a ferry boat. It doesn't hold 100 people, probably only 40 or 50, but it's a good size boat. Look how it's dwarfed by these cliffs. It's about a 1,500 foot drop, and then the crater goes way below. I think it's a 2 or 3 mile deep crater, full of water from the Aegean Sea. Okay, so now we're going to take a walk to the black sand beach, and then that'll be about the last main thing I'll show you. So some of these buildings, like this church, are precariously perched so much that they have to be abandoned. And in fact, this one was, when I walked up to it and then looked back at it, oh, I see why it's been closed for years. I wanted to go inside because it's about a 400-year-old church from Baroque times. Actually, we're going to No, we're not going that far in this class. That's 1.2. The early 1600s. It's what, 4 centuries old? And yet it's not safe for them to even, you know, sit in the building, let alone hold services with dozens of people inside. So it's been abandoned because of the slippage. Yes, they have earthquakes there. They haven't had a volcanic eruption in over 3,000 years. And they may again, but it's not an active volcano. Sorry, but they do have mild earthquakes. Can see how the damage was over the decades. And then this is a modern Italian. I actually talked to the people. I didn't want to get their photo, and they didn't want me to get them in their photo. But it's they're from Italy, and they vacation here on Santorini because it's such a beautiful space. And they had the money to build themselves a modern, somewhat traditional Italian Renaissance looking, but with these Minoan style columns, almost, or slight modified version of them. It's quite beautiful. And that's volcanic stone on the tiles, if it's not obvious, the black stone. It was the black sand beach. And for some reason, I don't know, I just thought it'd be interesting to see it. And this monastery is from the 1200s, the 13th century. So that puts it as what, about eight centuries ago. And they were, the nuns in the monastery, smart enough not to go out in the noonday sun. Foolishly, as a tourist, I wasn't listening to the advice and the warnings in town, don't do that. I walked all the way across the island. It's not that wide, but still it's a few miles from, you know, the town to this beach, which there was the beach. And then I realized why people said not to do it. I started to get heat stroke. It's pretty serious if you don't watch out. And I remember thinking, uh-oh, I didn't bring enough water. It's about when I ran out of the water, when I was the farthest away from the town, which I had to get back to at a certain time because we had tickets, me and my then girlfriend, to get on a specific ferry. There's only one ferry a day to get off the island. Otherwise, I'd be stuck on the island and, you know, you'd just lose your money. And who knows how long it'd take to get another ferry ticket. So I had to turn around and walk quickly back, but I ran into some problems. This is a NATO, everyone knows what NATO is now, right? Maybe the only thing containing Putin. The Greeks are part of NATO. And this is, you know, a factory on a military base, a NATO base, run, of course, by Greek military. It was an Air Force base. I mean, I had no idea there was such a thing on this island. It's not that big an island. And there's this old 500 probably year old church outside the barbed wire, and the barbed wire is the edges of the fence. But I went ahead and walked in because I was dying of thirst. I thought, well, maybe I can get some water. And I thought, well, maybe I shouldn't do that because it's a military base. When I walked into the gate, it was open. The gate was wide open, and the guard box, sentry box, the door of that was off its hinges, and it was lying on the ground next to the sentry box. And the guard that was supposed to be guarding the entrance to that military base was sleeping with some kind of covering over his face so he wouldn't get a sunburn on top of that disengaged door on the ground. I turned around and walked away. I said, if I wake him up, he's going to arrest me. So I didn't get my water there. These are churches that have nothing to do with the base, but they were, of course, built before the base. But this was one of my favorites. Look at this. beautiful piece of architecture. It reminds me of the old chapels in rural Mexico. I've been all over Mexico, and it's fascinating to see 500-year-old churches in the villages of Mexico and sometimes in the mountains. That bell is probably nearly as old, if not as old, as the church itself. Okay, so we're going to end up with just about half a dozen more slides. This is a crop circle, right, where the wheat and the chaff are separated, whatever the farmers bring there, or this farmer brings a crop. And this is where I thought I was going to meet the great beyond. I literally was delirious, borderline delirious, and it's pretty serious. You got to be really careful when you're in an environment like this. I mean, I did have a hat and sunscreen, but that's not enough when you're dehydrated and the heat is 112, 14 degrees and there's no shade. Luckily for me, some British couple in a fancy car, I can't remember what kind it was a BMW, was driving along that road just at that point, and somehow they saw me. Literally, I was on my knees and I was trying to figure out if I could make it to that road and what would happen if I did, would I get a ride? They rolled their window down and yelled, "Would you like a ride, sir?" Thank heavens, yes, I said, please. So I managed to get out of that in one piece. Let's go to the last few views here. These are wonderful walls. This is another abandoned building. You might be able to tell that because it just, you know, clinging to that same hillside is actually across that little narrow road from the church I showed you a few slides back. So some parts of the edges of the island are not as safe as others. But you can see the volcanic stone is what's not covered over in plaster, so that's what's underneath all the plaster. All right, and then don't do this. Besides, you know, not going far away from civilization in a hot climate where there's no water available and no shade, don't rent donkeys on any of the Greek islands. I heard from all kinds of tourists from all over the world, not just Americans, complaining. What happens is you pay $200 or something, and you give your passport to the people who own the donkeys, and then you think you can put all your stuff on them, and that relieves you of carrying a heavy backpack or whatever your luggage is, your camera equipment. What happens is the donkeys take off with everything you own or have with you across the island, and you'll never see them again, and then eventually someone finds the donkeys and takes the stuff off the back, and you have to then forfeit your $200 and pay extra to get your passport back. Not worth the risk. So forget the donkeys. It's not a way to go. They were all over the island wandering around by themselves. So the last two slides are on the way back to the ferry boat dock. You see, there's the town we saw from a different side of the island. And here are those volcanic cliffs. And then the last slide is leaving the island through the opening in the crater that I showed you on the first slide when we arrived at night, heading back to the mainland of Greece. It's quite an experience. And I think now that I've been there, once I was there and I researched it, I think it easily could have been, as very likely to be, the most likely single island of the ancient Greek islands, where there was, you know, some evidence that a culture similar to what the legend of ancient Atlantis is, advanced, culturally peaceful as the Minoans were, and then suddenly just destroyed by nature. Probably was, most likely, I think it was, the source for the legend of Atlantis. Okay, I hope you enjoyed that. So we're ending 2 minutes early. I will now do any questions. I'll stick around, I always do. If you have questions about the papers or anything we saw tonight, extra credit.
No, I don't.
Anybody? Because yeah, this is your chance to do that. Of course, you can always email me, but don't forget the papers are due next Monday. And by midnight gives you the option, if you need it, to do a little extra tweaking of your paper, whatever, polishing of it, as long as it's in before midnight or by midnight.
Sorry, I do have a question. It is the midterm next week?
Oh, no, that not in this class. The midterm is in March, March after the, sure, I'll tell you what's on your syllabus. I'll go ahead and just, if you flip ahead, it's on March 28th. It has to be. Yeah, because it's after the spring break. See, what we do is we have 2 more weeks of new slides, and then we review. For the next 2 lectures, it's new slides and at the end of the second week, 2 weeks from tonight, we review for the midterm. Then it's spring break, and then so it's the Monday after spring break. I will send you an email and tell everybody what the day, and thank that's you. At the beginning of of a class that you'll be able to have up to an hour and a half if you need, but you won't need that long. It's a 1 hour exam. So anybody that needs extra time, it's called time and a half because you have special arrangements, and every class I've had a few students have that arrangement with the Office of Abilities, as it's called. You'll have that. It'll be built in. In fact, you have till midnight. What am I saying? You'll have till midnight. Yeah, that's right, because this is an online class. So, but that's not until 3 weeks from now. No,
okay.
Four weeks from today. Yeah,
thank you. Bye.
Okay. Papers are what are due next week. All right.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other questions about the test? Well, not the test. That's we already covered that. The papers or what we saw tonight. Well, all right, you guys, thanks for your comments and your questions. I appreciate that. Always makes it more interesting. And extra credit options, don't forget, nobody's done more than about 10 points. You still have up to 60 points. Most people have all of those extra credit options available. All right, one more time, last call. Anybody have any questions about anything we covered tonight or anything having to do with your grades or your papers? I assume I'll see most of your papers by the time we start class next week. Don't forget to send them to Mark W. if you want them graded more quickly and returned to you more quickly. If you send Outlook, you will get them back and they'll be on time, but it takes longer to download those. So you can do both if you want to cover your base. All right, that's it. Good night. Take care. See you all next week. Have a good week.